The NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing.com has officially begun. It's all in control of Brad Davies in that 11 machine. Green flag flies. He's damn near banged up though. Now the 93 is going to push the 4 of Brian Day all the way up the wall. 4 wide down the super stretch point in the front. And now the 93-39, the 3 machine goes around. Big trouble in the back. It's been the race for the win up front.
Look behind him. They're 3 and 4 wide trying to make a push to the front as the field gains speed in turn number 1. Kenny Humphrey, if he can rip it back to the start finish line, will win here at Daytona.
7 laps.
Oh, oh Brian you love Davies, it. Here we go.
You love it. One gets around, the 5 gets around. Big choke.
The road to $10,000 runs through the Monster Mile. This is Dover International Speedway. This is round number 8 of the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing, and we are getting ready to tackle the monster for 200 laps in the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing.com. Tim Terry, Tony Stevens, Joe Cortez here to call all the action for you. We got a special guest commentator in the wings as well. We'll introduce him in just a few moments' time. But Tony, this is where everything starts to get a little bit exciting. The points are tight at the top. This is around that time in the season where it's make or break. And at a racetrack like Dover, it could break, and it could break really quickly.
It really can, Tim. And actually, Dover, if you remember last season, was one of those races that was a pivotal event in the championship. Now, Dover was later in the schedule than what it is this year, but remember, Ray Alfala was running, I think, what, fourth or fifth at the time? Tyler Hudson right in front of him. The championship was Ray's to lose, and what happened? Ray got caught up in an incident, the second one in as many races, lost what point lead he had, and it was a completely different championship picture at the end of that Dover event. Being in the middle of the season, that might change things, especially with the drop this season, Joe. But what it doesn't change is the fact that this is Dover. This is the Monster Mile, and no matter what, you cannot let your guard down.
You cannot let your guard down even for a moment here. It's only a mile in length, but this mile will come out, grab you, and take you for a ride if you let it. This race is of critical importance, guys. This race is the hub race of the 15-week NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series presented by iRacing.com. So these guys are going to be looking for a lot of... These guys will be looking for a good run here because this run is going to be important. This run could ultimately decide where they're going to be going into the mini chase, if you will, that they have here in the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series. But more importantly, a bad run here could make the difference between, ultimately, later on as the season goes down, make the difference between you making the chase and not making the chase.
And 2 weeks ago, we were at the Charlotte Motor Speedway for what was round number 7 on the series. Of course, we did have one event that was canceled at Richmond International Raceway, so round number 7 at Charlotte. Went to Danny Hansen, first-time winner in the series. He had to hold off another guy that was looking for his first win, Chad Lawton. Michael Conti finished in third. Brandon Schmidt, Cody Bias, Justin Bolton, Nick Ottinger, Jake Sturgis, Alex Warren, and Trey Idson, your top 10 in that race at Charlotte. So there's a couple of new names that we saw in that top 10, a new first-time winner in this series, and now there's other drivers that are looking for that first-time win in this series. Chad Lawton takes over the point lead, Tony, and he's looking for some big things here this evening. And speaking about big things, you've caught up with our guest commentator that's going to hang out with us here this evening in Dover.
Absolutely, Tim, and yeah, big things for Danny Hansen last week, big things for Chad Lawton. Really winning this NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series championship in itself is a big thing. In fact, defending series champion Tyler Hudson going to be making a trip to Charlotte, North Carolina this weekend to participate in the second annual Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge. And one of the guys joining us in the booth here is, well, the original Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge winner, Patrick Staropoli. So first off, Pat, great to have you here. And we look forward to having some insight from you so far tonight on Dover and what can kind of happen here. Tell us kind of briefly what the Stock Car Dream Challenge has done for your career in the last year or so.
Hey guys, well, first of all, thank you very much for having me on the broadcast tonight. I'm really looking forward to it. Played a little bit of iRacing before, and this is my first time sitting in the booth with you guys, so I'm really looking forward to the race. And You know, it's been a crazy journey the whole past year since winning the Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge, and it's really taken my career from a grassroots level, just racing late models in Florida, to now, you know, running in the NASCAR K&N series and winning out at Irwindale this year. So basically, it's given my career like a huge spring boost to be able to meet the right people and put myself in the right place to get noticed by some of these big teams. And really just comparing where I was at a year ago to where I am now, I can't believe the shoes, you know, that I'm sitting in. So it's a huge opportunity. Really excited that the iRacing guys are getting in on it this year, and it should be a great show.
You know, and tell us real quick about that Irwindale race, because that was probably, at least the way we kind of looked at it, probably the greatest thing ever could happen to Peak. I mean, this was an opportunity of a lifetime as it was. And then to go out in a car prepared by Bill McAnally and beat a lot of guys like Brandon McReynolds and Greg Pursley and people like that run that series each and every week. What was that like for you? I'm sure you're going to have to use the word dream in this explanation, because we couldn't think of anything more dreamlike than the entire ascension to that win.
Yeah, I'll start off with that then. It was a dream come true. I mean, you know, when you look at, like you said, Pursley, Mayhew, those guys who have run the West Series for a long time. I mean, when I was a kid, I was watching races on Speed Channel when they were running in the West Series, you know. So they have a ton of laps and a ton of experience at a place like Irwindale. And, you know, for me to go there the first time and all we had was practice the day of the race. And then the race actually in itself turned out to be a game of strategy with tire conservation and everything like that. So to be able to go out there and beat those guys kind of on their home turf when I don't have nearly, you know, the experience or background that they do, I think says a lot about, you know, the kind of the whole competition that Peak's put together, that they're really looking for people with talent who can go out there and win races immediately. And, you know, it was just, you know, crazy that I could sit here and say that we won that race, but it happened.
Well, hey, that's the cool part about it. Now, of course, you talk about how all that transpired. You've been on iRacing. Realistically, because you've been through the competition, realistically, what kind of shot do the two iRacing drivers have to have the same opportunity you've been given this season?
You know, I'd say they have as good a shot as anybody that's in there. I mean, I've been running late models now for probably 5 or 6 years, and they're so different than the cars that we drove at the Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge last year. I mean, the Richard Petty driving experience cars that we use are so much heavier. They drive so much more different than anything I've, you know, personally done on asphalt, that sometimes it puts you at a disadvantage because you're looking for a certain feel that you've developed in one car, and then you go there and you immediately have to do something else. And I think what's great about iRacing and, you know, the time I've spent playing on it is it really you know, replicates very closely kind of the dynamics of whatever car you're driving. And so, you know, going to these tracks and being able to drive these cars in an environment that simulates them, I think it gives them just as much of a background on these particular cars as any race car driver in real life could have. So, you know, I'm looking forward to seeing how Tyler does in the competition list next week. I got to meet him at Homestead last year, and you know, it's really cool to get that opportunity for people who haven't been able to actually go real racing in their life to you know, be on this sim racer and go out there and get a real shot at it.
Well, Pat, thanks for joining us, and of course we look forward to your insight tonight. And Joe, what a better day, or there's really not much of a better day or night for somebody like Patrick Staropoli to join us here, because it looks like a perfect day for racing.
Absolutely going to be a perfect day for racing here on the track at Dover International Speedway. Weather on the track, clear skies, 74 degrees with a slight breeze coming out of the south at 4 miles per hour. Relatively low humidity out here, so these cars are going to be running in optimal condition. The big question is, with this weather, with weather being a non-factor in tonight's race, which one of these 36 drivers is going to be able to tame the monster at Dover?
We'll find out in just a few moments' time. Chad Lawton leads us into battle this evening. Mike Conti, Jake Sturgis, Nick Ottinger, your top four. Kenny Humphrey, not here, suspended from an incident last week on lap 176, or 2 weeks ago. So he is not here this evening, suspended because of the incident threshold and the point system that they have in that. Ray Alfala, Danny Hansen, Brian Day, Matt Busa, Tom Lewandowski, your top 10. It is close in points. This could be a deciding factor in who starts to break away from the rest of this field if Chad Lawton can come out of here with a good finish. We step away now for just a few moments' time. When we come back, we'll bring you the starting grid for the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing Round at the Dover International Speedway. Don't go away.
this is where it gets difficult. This is where your name's on the line, everything's on the line. You get that one chance to go out there and put down your best performance with the most amount of pressure.
You got to take this race car, this whole new group of people, go to the racetrack, somehow impress them, and oh, by the way, you got to do it now. It's now or never.
First thing that went through my mind was like, no way.
Just be real important to try to figure out how many tires under him and run a smart 150 laps.
They might bump him around a little bit, but what doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Everybody should enter next year's contest because you never know what could happen, man. You come out here, run top five in your first K&N West race. So I'm so psyched right now. This is incredible.
What's inside peak antifreeze? 65 years of experience in hot and cold protection. From an independent, family-owned business that's never been afraid to give you exactly what's right for your engine and your wallet. Peak. Run true.
The NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing. About to go green at Dover. 200 laps. And let's go down your starting grid on the pole. It's a number. Let's see here. We got the 5 of Mike Conti on the pole position with a 22.1 to the outside. It's the 2 of Ray Alfala.
Joey Brown in the car, number 12, will start 3rd, and good run for P.J. Sturgis. He'll start 4th in the 57.
The 32 of Danny Hansen starts position number 5 on the outside of him. The 19 of Mitchell Hunt starts 6th.
You get your point leader, Chad Lawton, starting in 7 to the outside at 16, Tom Lewandowski.
Brian Schoenberg in the double nickel starts 9th, and Matt Busa in the 34 rolls off to his outside.
Row number 6 belongs to the 53 of Brandon Hawk on the inside, the 33 of Ryan Blackford on the outside.
Brad Davey starts in 13th to the outside. The fastest driver in warm-up was Kevin King.
Adam Gillen in car number 8. He'll start to the inside of row number 8. And Nick Ottinger, one of the fastest guys in the series, will start to his outside.
The 27 of Cody Pius starts position number 17 as they roll off the field. The 13 of Brad Mayhar starts 18th.
We got Chris Overland in 19th, completing your top 20, Ashley Miller.
Alex Warren, Michael J. Johnson, Rob Ackley, Josh Berry, and Alex Scribner are the next 5.
26, Andrew Fash, a 3rd, Justin Bolton, 27, Stephen Gilbert, 28, Brandon Bowie, 29th, and the 4, Ryan Day, rounds out the top 30.
Completing your field, it is the 89 of Landon Harrison, the 3 of Brandon Schmidt, and Robert Hall, Trey Idson, Jake Sturgis, Peter Bennett, and Brandon Hoff. Completing your field of 37 drivers, getting ready to go green this time by the iRacing.com Ford Mustang pace car leads the field. The 5 of Mike Conti looking to get a little bit closer to the top of the heap when it comes to the point standings and try to edge out Chad Lawton. Lawton starts in position number 7 this evening. Pace car is going to peel off here. Field of command of Mike Conti working slowly through corner number 4. When does he pick up the pace? He's going to go here. Green flag flies. We are underway in the 2. Little slow to the hop. The 5 of Conti is gone. It's side by side for 3rd. Give it to Brown. And the 57 now. Tony stuck on the outside.
Yeah, P.J. Sturgis stuck to the outside, but he'll quickly get down in line. And to nobody's surprise, everyone single file, or at least trying to get single file here in the early going. 200 laps here at the Monster Mile. A very, very long race. And Joe, it looks like everybody has that in mind. Only a couple of two-wide battles as lap number 1 goes on the board.
The 34, the 33, they're going to be one of your two-line battles. The 34, Matt Busa trying to get back in line. The 11 of Brad Davies won't let that happen. So the 34 will be forced to take the high line around the track once again. That's got to be hard on those brand-new multi-zone tires that they've got on these simulated Sprint Cup Gen 6 cars out there. Because the harder they run these tires, the quicker they're going to go away on the track. And the Monster is not kind to those ponies who don't have any shoes.
It might be easy to say Brad Davies had a tough week last week. A couple of wrecks coming onto pit road and didn't finish where he wanted to. Now he's looking at the 33 of Brian Blackford for position number 11 as they come up at a 4. They'll complete 3 laps this time by and start lap number 4 of 200. Up in front, it's all single file throughout your top 10 as these drivers, Tony, try to pick off positions as they can. You mentioned long green flag run mentality. We've had some races where we've seen some green flag runs, and we've had some races where we've seen a lot of caution. So these guys trying to pick up what they can do for green flag running, and it looks like it's doing good so far. Four laps completed.
Yeah, I think that's a welcome change for some of these drivers after the way some of these races have started, Tim. Just kind of settle in, make some laps, and of course, you know, Patrick, you've driven these things, maybe not so much a Gen 6 car, but a NASCAR K&M Pro Series car at places similar to Dover. Well, then again, nothing's quite like Dover, I guess, but what's it like when you're in the car trying to make laps? Is it anything similar to what you've experienced on iRacing, and what is it, the same mindset that these guys are probably going through now, you think?
Yeah, I mean, Dover's a pretty big, fast track, but I think the closest thing I can compare it to is when we ran Bristol earlier this year. And, you know, definitely with the K&N cars, similar to kind of what these guys are driving in this race, you know, the weight is such a factor on how you wear out the tires. And so pretty much from the beginning of the run, you're trying to find a good place to ride and manage your stuff and hope you have something there left at the end of the run.
Justin Bolton trying to do everything he can to save something for the end of this very first run out there. He's going to be having a hard time out there. The 36 continues to drop through the field as he runs the long way around the track. Now getting passed by the 69 of Peter Bennett. Look for Justin Bolton. He scored around position number 36. Meanwhile, closer to up front, the 32 and 19 doing business side by side. That's going to be the 19 of Mitchell Hunt, looking to take away some position from the 32 of Danny Hansen. And look who's coming along for the ride. Chad Lawton, your point leader. He's going to now try to worm his way into the top five.
26, or that 32 lost three positions there. He got passed by PJ Sturgis. Sturgis opened the door for the 19 and the 26 car to move up those three spots. So we'll see Danny Hansen move back a few spots in this run of the race. And Tony, we saw it last week. Danny Hansen, we really didn't hear about Danny Hansen until the last quarter of the race. Then all of a sudden, he's up front battling for the win at Charlotte.
Yeah, it was. And really, it wasn't a surprise when we go back and look at the way that race played out, because Hansen was there. He was in the top five, the top 10 all night long, and just slowly made his way forward. And when the right time came, it was preparation meeting opportunity. He was prepared with a good car. The opportunity presented itself, and that's where he was. As we watch this battle a little bit further back, Brad Davies and Brian Blackford. As Blackford now hung on the outside, and it wouldn't surprise me, Joe, if we see Danny Hansen maybe steal two in a row here. I still think it would be under the radar, because last week's win was such a surprise that I don't think anybody has him picked in their fantasy league this week.
In the first seven races of this 2014 campaign, we have not had a two-time winner yet. The drivers that have won include Jake Sturgis, Michael Conti, who's leading now, Nick Ottinger, Kenny Humphrey, who's not on the track, Danny Hansen, who won 2 weeks ago, and Kevin King as well. So far, no repeat winners, but that could all change. Remember, this is Dover, and Dover tends to do strange things to these settings. One guy who definitely wants to try to win it is Michael Conti. He's got a good lead so far, 0.3 seconds over the two-time champion, Ralph Allen.
I like the looks of those guys running 4th and 5th right now, though, at least early in this race. PJ Sturgis in the 57 and the 19 of Mitchell Hunt. Mitchell Hunt has had no luck this season. That's probably the easiest way to put it. In the reallucky.com, number 19, he chases the 57 down of PJ Sturgis, one of the last row motorsports drivers in that 57, looking for a break, trying to get something going in this season. He started off the season with two consecutive last place finishes at Daytona and the second race of the season. So he needs some sort of luck to turn around here, as we have the 33 also going at it, trying to pick up some more spots, but Tony's not going to do it on the outside line.
Well, not very easily, at least. He might be able to do it, but there's not going to be a whole lot left of that race car if he's able to make it happen. And really no surprise, Nick Ottinger starting his march forward as well. Back there as well is Cody Bias in the number 27 machine, just ahead of that group. Actually met his crew chief at the Charlotte Motor Speedway last weekend during 600 weekend. Chatted a little bit about the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series here and said, Cody's going to be a threat here in the very near future. You watch out. That was not his only top five finish of the season. And pretty much he promised me that Cody's going to be a threat for the rest of the year. Well, if qualifying was any indication, they've got a little bit of work to do, Joe. However, 200 laps of the monster, and qualifying doesn't mean a whole heck of a lot.
Qualifying doesn't mean a whole lot out here as we take a look at the number two machine on the rear bumper of the 12. Joey Brown able to get the position away from Ray Alfalo. Ray Alfalo drops from second to third. Joey Brown comes out of nowhere, literally and physically, to end up taking away that second place position. And now he's on the hunt for Michael Conti for position number one. Joey Brown, he's had an up and down season throughout this year. The number 12 bar, the electric machine, looking for a little bit of retribution tonight. And if you can tame the monster, that's all the retribution you need for an entire season, I'd say.
Missed a couple races at the start of the season, did Joey Brown, but now he is a former winner in this series from last season, looking to pick up another victory here at Dover. He is closing in just a little bit on Mike Conti in the number five as they work down the back straightaway. We will complete 19 laps this time by. They have all been under the green flag. It's Conti, Brown, Alfalo, Sturgis, and Hunt, but Alfalo has fallen back now to the 57 and the 19, and Mitchell Hunt is the 12 has a moment in front of him.
Joey Brown just about bought the farm right there, Tim. How he saved that race car, I will never know. That was a handful and a half. And Mitchell Hunt, even though we were watching Joey Brown, Mitchell Hunt got a little sideways seeing that happen. He pounced on the binders and shifted the load in the car. Two just about bought the inside wall. So already Miles is getting a little bit hungry, and somehow it looks like Joey Brown escaped the grasp of the concrete monster here.
Take a look one more time at that number 12 of Joey Brown, but able to rescue that machine after almost buying the farm out there. The 12 coming off of turn number four, that's going to be a trouble spot you're going to see all night here, guys. Coming off of turn number four, you have a tendency to overdrive that turn. If you get on the gas too hard, too soon, you can spin those tires behind you and kick that car loose real easy. And you see that right there, the replay, that's exactly what Joey Brown did. He overdrove it, got the gas a little early, kicked the rear end out of it, and they is able to save it. Good news is he's able to get back in line. He's able to start battling for position again, but fifth is not second. Fifth is not where he wants to be.
The two had lost second place to the 12. He gains it back after that slide, but he is under fire from the 57 of PJ Sturgis. Looks like the two may have turned up the wick a little bit here in these last couple of laps because he's pulled away a little bit from Sturgis in the 57, but it moves Sturgis to position number three. Great run so far for the number 57, and then you have Mitchell Hunt and Joey Brown in fourth and fifth, and it looks like Brown is under fire from the 26 of Chad Lawton. Lawton is on the bumper of the Barley Electrical number 12 as they work through one and two. And it looks like Danny Hansen back there trying to close in on this battle as well.
You know, if I'm Chad Lawton, I'm a little careful right now. I saw what happened to Joey Brown on turn number four, and I don't know that I want to be tucked up underneath of his rear bumper, mainly because if the same thing happens, I might get taken away with him in the same five-ticket ride. So that might not be a good thing, but by the same token, Joe, you kind of have to work the guy and get by him because it is apparent that Joey Brown is holding up Chad Lawton, and here he goes. He'll get the runoff turn number two and work his way underneath him in turn number three. So move Chad Lawton now into the top five. Joey Brown back to sixth.
Chad Lawton, one of those brand new Toyota Camrys they released just a couple weeks ago. He's now going to be in the top five for not the first time tonight, but certainly one of the few times tonight. Lawton has a lot on the line here tonight. He came in to tonight's race only 13 points ahead of both Jake Sturgis and Michael Conti. So Lawton knows what's on the line here, and I think that's got to be weighing on him. There's no more stressful place in, Watkins Glen. There's no more stressful place in this circuit, in this entire series, to defend your championship or defend your lead than at Dover.
And speaking about defending championships, when we went through that lineup, you might have mentioned Tyler Hudson's not here this evening, the defending champion not at Dover International Speedway for this event. So not going to throw anything out there, Tony, but this might be the straw that breaks the camel's back for Tyler Hudson. He missed a race earlier in the season because he hit the incident threshold. Too many incident points, and he was not allowed to compete in one of the races earlier in the season. This may be the straw that breaks the camel's back. But now, if you are a guy like Chad Lawton, yes, you can build a lead here, Tony. But looking back, Ray Alfalo had a full race lead last season. Tyler Hudson came back in three races and won the championship. So no lead is safe in this NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing. But if you can build that lead early, it doesn't hurt.
No, it never hurts to have a lead because it gives you a little bit of insurance when we get down to those final few races so you know what you're up against. And I think Tyler, looking at kind of how his season went, it wouldn't surprise me if he took the opportunity because he's one of 18 finalists, remember, in the Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge, Tim. So there's a lot involved in that. It's not a matter of just fly to Charlotte, show up, and pull a number out of a hat. You're going to be taxed. I mean, you're going to have to drive race cars. Your physical endurance is going to be tested. Your mental stamina is going to be tested. There's other skills they're going to look for and you're going to have to work on. So it really wouldn't surprise me if Tyler said, look, this is a bigger opportunity thanks to this series. As we see Sturgis now looking underneath Ray Alfala, it wouldn't surprise me if Tyler said that's a bigger opportunity in Charlotte next week and he focused all of his effort on that, because quite frankly, it really is. I mean, look what happened to Patrick. I mean, can you blame him, Patrick?
No, I can't blame him. It's a huge opportunity, and it's really cool what Pete's been able to do teaming up with iRacing this year. And kind of going back the other way a little bit, we have some interesting plans in the works with me and Slip Angle Motorsports here coming up that hopefully we'll be able to announce here pretty soon. Me and Ray Alfala are getting together on something, so keep on lookout for that.
Meanwhile, back on the track, Michael Conti continues to lead. He's led all 33 laps here at Dover with no intention of letting him go. Right now, his lead 2.3 seconds on the rest of this field. That might as well be an eternity, guys. Michael Conti might be the one to beat out here. We'll have to keep an eye on him. BJ Sturgis in second. It'll be Ray Alfala now third. Your points there, Chad Lawton fourth, and Joey Brown rounding out your top five. Other notables in the group right now, Tom Lewandowski in eighth, Danny Hansen seventh, Ryan Schoenberg in ninth, Brad Davies rounding out your top 10, and the fastest in practice, Kevin King, he's running 12.
Ray Alfala going to lose two here. He's going to fall back to position number five, and that's exactly what Mitchell Hunt just did about two laps before that. 26 and the 12 also passed the 19 to dispatch the 19 back to position number six. 32 with Danny Hansen also looks on this battle. Meanwhile, up in front, Tony, Joe mentioned it, Michael Conti's gone 2.5 seconds over PJ Sturgis, and Sturgis has about a half second or so on Chad Lawton. But Chad Lawton and Joey Brown had that slide earlier. Chad Lawton's been methodically working his way to the front of the field. They're both coming, and coming quickly, to the front of this field.
They are, and really I'm kind of impressed with Joey Brown. After that slide, he was able just to kind of hang back and cool the tires of that machine, make sure everything was still straight, and get his wits about him. And now here he is, motoring his way forward once again, as you said, up to fourth, maybe making a challenge on Chad Lawton momentarily for the third spot, as Ray Alfala is going the wrong way, Joe. Here comes Danny Hansen going by him. Looks like Mitchell Hunt maybe going to try to do the same thing. What in the world is wrong with Ray Alfala halfway through this run?
Halfway through this run, Ray Alfala definitely going the wrong way there. I've got a feeling they've got that car set up for the short sprints and not the long run. Anytime you can get 38, 40, 50 laps under your belt here at Dover, it's an excellent run. And these guys are definitely seeing that run happen now. And I've got a feeling Ray Alfala was set up more for the shorter run, more for the yellow flag runs that we were planning on seeing out here tonight. As a 19 machine now has the same exact problem. The real lucky machine of Mitchell Hunt, he's going to lose two, maybe three positions if Brad Davies has anything to say about him. Getting around him will be the 16 of Tom Lewandowski and the 55 of Ryan Schoenberg. But Alfala might have that car set up for a different kind of run out here, and as soon as they start coming in for pit stops, he might just have to come in and get some adjustments made on that number two.
The 19 car continues to fall back. The 05 of Nick Ottinger looking over the 19 for position at number 11 right now. We're checked position number 10 as the 05 looks to the inside of the 19 to pick up one spot here. 34 of Matt Busa going to try to follow him through as well to pick up one more spot. I did talk to crew chief Jordan Hightower on the number 89 of Landon Harrison. They said they can go about 70 laps on the fuel, Tony, but they might want tires before that point. He says that it cliffs around lap 40. We are working lap 41 right now, so they can make it to 70, but Jordan told me they're probably not going to go to 70. They're probably going to come in a little bit earlier.
And really, if you look at the way that shakes out, well, never mind. Adam Gilliland's on pit road, Tim. Speaking of coming down pit road, first driver to come onto pit lane, and Gilliland down at a very, very slow, tortoise-like pace, 35 miles per hour, and finally going to make it to his stall just past start-finish. He'll come in, and we do anticipate a four-tire stop. Crew is around to the right side. They'll service both of those tires. Five off and five on, and go back around to the left side. That side of the car is in the air. Mitchell Hunt also now on pit road. He'll come in for four tires, as it appears pit stop starting already 40 laps into this race. Alfalfa also on pit road, Joe, as are others.
Mitchell Hahn will make it a four-tire stop in the number 19 RealLucky.com Chevrolet. It'll be four tires and 2 days of virtual Sunoco racing fuel. Ray Alfalfa now coming to the attention of his crew. Look for the wrench to go into that car to try to get some adjustments made. Maybe add a little bit of wedge, maybe something else, maybe even a tire pressure adjustment for the two of Ray Alfalfa as he makes his way through the second pit stall up front. Four virtual Goodyear Eagles, 2 tanks of Sunoco racing fuel, and Ray Alfalfa should be on and off pit road as fast as they can get him. Left sides go down, right side, left sides go down. He is down and away. Alfalfa with a quick stop.
Top 10 that last time by, continue to stay on the racetrack, led by Mike Conti. He now has a 3.3-second lead on Chad Lawton, Joey Brown, PJ Sturgis, and Danny Hansen. Five will stay out on the racetrack, complete 45 on the racetrack. Chad Lawton comes down to the pit road. Two surrenders set back in place. Brian Day is also on the pit road. Joey Brown stays out, Sturgis, and it looks like Chad Lawton, only one within the top five, Tony, that is going to come down on this lap. Justin Bolton in behind him.
Lawton on pit road and his Toyota, and again, slowly at 35 miles per hour. He's going to go pretty much the entire length of pit road to reach his crew, all the way by the entrance to victory lane, and finally, he'll reach his box. He'll stop on the mark, and the crew will go around to the right side. A little bit of damage on the right side of the 26 machine of Lawton. He's been into somebody or something. They'll try to pull that away from the tires best they can in such a quick hurry. Left side service completed. Chad Lawton is down and away as we are still green, surprisingly, through this very early round of pit stops, Joe.
Justin Bolton now going off pit road as he gets four tires and a full tank of fuel in 53. Brandon Hoth looking for the exact same thing. And the big thing you're seeing right here is it's all about tire strategy. It's all about keeping the tires fresh underneath you and making the tires work. Let's take a look now at the two of Ray Alfalfa as he continues to get quagmired in traffic. Now he might get one lap down as Nick Ottinger. Check that, he is one lap down as Nick Ottinger now trying to get around him.
And that's the advantage of the tires. Ray is actually laps down right now, but he made quick work of the 0532. Caution out.
Oh, and Tim, this is, you know, we were just getting ready as this kind of played out to kind of talk to Patrick a little bit about what's this like when you have this type of cycle of pit stops, but never mind. Now we know caution is out, and that pretty much, Joe, has screwed everybody that pitted in this situation, for lack of a better term. Yeah, they can get the wave round, and yeah, they can work their way forward, but they've really got themselves behind the eight ball right now as Ashley Miller went around in turn number one in the number seven car. They've really got to dig out of a hole here, everybody that came down pit road.
This is not what they wanted to see. This is not the situation they wanted to be in. As we take a look at this replay again, the number one of Ashley Miller, again coming off of turn number four, runs out of real estate trying to overdrive it around the 11 of Brad Davies, gets into Davies. Davies hits the wall, hits the inside wall. The number one of Ashley Miller, though, hits that safer barrier nose first. And Ashley Miller, heavy front end damage on that Toyota Camry. He's going to need a lot of help getting back and getting that car in working condition, as it looks like they're going to go ahead and get it towed back to the garage. More importantly, though, all those guys who did come down pit road, they are now in a world of hurt. They are now in a huge hole there that they've got to try to figure out a way to get unburied from. Just getting an idea of who's now one lap down. Chad Lawton's one lap down. Ray Alfalfa's one lap down. Mitchell Hunt, Kevin King at two laps down. Cody Bias, two laps down. Josh Berry, two laps down. The good news is for some of these guys, though, they might be able to get a wave around and they might be able to get their lap back because they can stay out.
Alfalfa, Lawton, I believe, stayed out on the racetrack. They will get the wave around. They were two laps down. They'll get the wave around and be the tail end of one lap down. They'll still need something and something big to happen. They dug themselves a huge hole by pitting that little bit early. Conti came off pit road, four tires and fuel, and it was a quick stop for the number five. He is going to maintain the lead. The 12 of Joey Brown is second off pit road, and the rest of the field, it looks status quo from here, Tony. I didn't see any mistakes on pit road for those guys that did stay out on the racetrack.
Yeah, it looked pretty much like normal routine service. Four tires and fuel for everybody. Maybe a couple of small adjustments, but nothing earth-shattering by any means. For everybody that was still on the lead lap, and right now we're showing 18 cars still on the lead lap unofficially. Andrew Fiash III, the last of those as the other cars, one or more laps down, come to pit road. And we're just getting ready to ask Patrick Staropoli, as he's joined us here in the booth, the 2013 Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge winner. When you're in a situation like that, what's more on your mind? The fact that you are pretty much behind on pit strategy and having to go a short pit strategy, essentially, or the caution coming out? I mean, what weighs on your mind? I'm sure it can't be much different in the sim versus a real car when you're in a pit strategy call like that.
Yeah, that was definitely a tough situation right there, because the race really had a green flag look to it, and I thought the good strategy was the short pit there, and you make up so much time on fresher tires, having that advantage for two or three laps while other guys are on old stuff. So I thought that'd be the golden ticket right there, and then the caution came out and spoiled all of it. So it'll be interesting to see how it plays out from here.
It really will. And one of the guys that kind of got the not-so-golden ticket out of the deal was your future teammate, Ray Alfalle. You mentioned earlier that you're going to be doing some stuff with Slip Angle Motorsports. I talked to Lisa and Ray and Brian at Charlotte, and I had a good little conversation, but it sounds like, without obviously telling us all the details, because all the I's and T's aren't dotted and crossed, but what exactly have you guys got planned coming up soon? It sounds like it's some pretty top-secret, hip deal.
Yeah, it's pretty top secret, so I can't confirm or deny any details of what we're working on right now, but it's pretty exciting stuff. You know, I got to meet Lisa down at Charlotte during the Coke 600 weekend a couple weeks ago, and we got to brainstorming on some things, and just kind of working out the details, and hopefully here in the next couple weeks we'll be able to announce something. But it's a really cool kind of plan that we're putting together, and I'm looking forward to it.
Well, certainly we're looking forward to seeing it as well. And Joe, looks like we're looking forward to going back racing here. The wave around, everybody has pretty much gotten it that was going to. And now Michael Conti, Joey Brown, PJ Sturgis, Nick Ottinger, and Danny Hansen are going to lead the field to green, Joe.
And the biggest winner out of all of that, Michael Conti. He had a 2.3 second run under the green flag. He was able to get service to his car without having the interruption of those other cars around him. So look for Michael Conti to have a huge run once again as they come through turns 3 and 4, getting ready to restart them for the first time on lap 53, a race over a quarter done.
We'll see what happens here and see if we get another green flag run of 50 laps. Pace car in, Conti getting ready to go on the hammer. And he brings him down slow once again, and he's going to go here. Green flag flies a little bit earlier than he did before. Sturgis was anticipating, though. Look at the start the 57 gets. He is out to second, and Joey Brown has to settle in for third. Hansen and Ottinger complete your top five as they work out of corner number two.
Single file quickly through the entire field, and really, that was aided by the restart. All the wave-around cars start at the tail end of the longer line, all single file, so that made life a little easier for everyone to get single file. But now the question is, Joe, what do you do for strategy if you are in this, say, this lead group, or some of these guys a lap down? If you're Ray Alfalle, it almost looks like the setup was what made the bed for you. You had no choice but to short pit because of how much time you lost. But if you're some of these other guys that came down because everybody else did, do you try to stretch it, you think, now? Or do you think about it now? What do you do, Joe? I mean, we're lap two in the run, but to me it appears we need to think about these things.
Tony, I was involved in a warm-up race last night, 160 laps here at Dover, and the biggest takeaway I learned from that are tires, 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 tires. Tires are going to be critical to walking away with this race in some way, shape, or form. And really, I think the tire wear is going to dictate when and how you make your moves when you make your pit stops. You know, Ray Alfalle, yes, he was in a situation where he needed to pit. He didn't have a choice. As soon as he saw others pitting, he took the opportunity to make it himself. As now we have a challenge for the lead up there. This could be the swan song of Mike Conti, as Mike Conti will lose not one but two positions. PJ Sturgis takes away the lead for the first time tonight. Joey Brown now in second. Michael Conti making me eat my words. He's now in third.
Michael Conti went the hill, and the 57 and the 12 drove underneath the 5 to the lead position. He might be saving something here, maybe anticipating another green flag run, but they may have thrown something at that car, Tony, because that thing looked evil off corner number 4 that time. He goes up the hill a little bit in corner number 1, they may have went the wrong way on an adjustment trying to make that car even better than it already was, because he's falling back off the pace now, the 57 and the 12. And there's the big story, Tony. The 57 of PJ Sturgis goes from dead last at Daytona to the lead at Dover, and he is trying to hold off the 12 of Joey Brown. He's got about three lengths or so on the 12 right now.
What a race for PJ Sturgis. I think already to this point has to be a career race for him. Qualified top five. He's running the top five all night. Wasn't by luck that he still was in the top five. He ran there despite the pit stops and now takes the lead under green from Mike Conti. What a run by PJ Sturgis so far. So impressed by this young man. And you know, he's got to be nervous behind the race car wheel right now, because this is a place he's not always at with these guys. He's got Joey Brown breathing down his neck. He just passed Mike Conti for the lead. He's smiling, no doubt. But back to Conti, Joe. Tim suggested, I mean, these guys threw something at the car. You're 5 seconds or 3 seconds or why? Why do you try to throw something? It's like, why do you try to throw something at the car? It's like Brad Davies has some problems in turn number two.
Brad Davies probably wants to throw something at the car. The 11 machine has blown up on the front stretch. He's just going to cruise it now down to pit road. Let's go ahead and take a look at the replay real quick and exactly what happened. Just before that, Brad Davies made contact with the wall through turns three and four, it looks like, and that's what's going to cause the chain reactions, let something go in that engine. Next thing you know, poof, it is gone. So Brad Davies, not a happy camper. He is going to be forced to call it a night as a result of that incident. Let's take a look now at position number 11 with Rob Ackley.
Rob Ackley, the 22 car, and just behind them, I believe there's some cars coming through the field. That's Ray Alfala in the 2. He is one lap down right now in position number 20. He is not in the free pass position. The free pass position is Chad Lawton. He is being chased by the 13 of Brad Mehar, about 5 or 6 car lengths behind him, and then right behind the 13 is the 2 of Ray Alfala. So, Tony, we got two races here. We got the battle for the lead, which Joey Brown just took the lead from P.J. Sturgis. He moves to the top of the board. P.J. Sturgis back to second, and keep a half eye on this free pass battle between the 26, 13, and 2. You throw in the 19 and the 29 in there, there's some really good cars that were caught 2 laps down because of that caution.
Yeah, there's a lot of good competition back there. You talked about them, Alfala, Lawton, Hunt, King, Cody Bias. I mean, there's a whole host of drivers that, if circumstances were different, might have a shot to win this race. But right now, they're trapped a lap down about a third of the way through this event. And yes, that free pass race, probably for the rest of the night, is going to be one of the fiercest battles to watch, depending on, of course, how the wave arounds and everything kind of play out over the course of the night. But I almost wonder now, as we watch this pass for the lead, the replay, Joey Brown getting by P.J. Sturgis, if you're Ray Alfala, Joe, if you're Chad Lawton, if you're any of these guys, do you maybe change your strategy at this point and try to make that car last 50, 60, even a full 70 laps or so, you think?
Well, I don't know if you have a choice, but as I was saying earlier there, Tony, this race is going to be dictated by tire wear and tire efficiency. If you can conserve the tires underneath you, if you can make the car work with the older tires, then sure, you can go 60, 70 laps out there. But the problem is, these new multi-zone tires that they've instituted here at iRacing have a completely different wear pattern. So conservation is critical, and conservation will dictate how they make their strategy go, and I think you're going to see some of that play out as the race continues to go on here. I think strategy...
Trouble, turn number 4, briefly, Chad Lawton checked up, sorry Joe, and he got punted, and now it looks like he has called it a day. Point leader Chad Lawton, major issue for him over in turn number 4, but it looks like we're going to stay green for the time being.
Chad Lawton got the boot, and that is going to hurt him. Looks like he's going to be behind the wall. If he's not pulled behind the wall, then he is going to be at least several laps down. And the only thing we know for certain now, there could very easily be a new point leader as a result of this race.
One thing I wanted to add, Joe, when you were talking about the strategy on this race, those guys like Ray Alfala, Mitchell Hunt, Kevin King, they all pitted around the lap 40-ish mark, lap 40 to 45 thereabouts. Talked to Jordan Hightower, he says this thing cliffs after about lap 40 or so. So even though there was a caution in there, that would be about 80, 85 or so where these tires will begin to not be as good as they were 40 laps before, and you might have to come down onto pit road. So, Tony, is that where the conservation comes in a little bit? Maybe you think about that. Now that Brad Maher is a free pass spot, Ray Alfala's got to get up to him. Ray Alfala can see the 13 in his windshield. He's just got to get up to him and pass him just in case there is a caution that flies. Oh, by the way, Mitchell Hunt's right behind him, too.
And he's in that race for the free pass spot. So it's a three-way battle there and certainly one to keep an eye on. And, you know, Tim, I don't know. You and Patrick are all on the 40-lap bandwagon. And, yeah, the tires might fall off after lap number 40 or so, but I don't think that 30 laps versus 30 laps staying on the racetrack, you lose enough time to warrant two laps in the pits. I really don't. If the race stays green, I tend to go the road course route. Just work it backwards and do what you've got to do, because you're not going to give up enough time on the racetrack, I don't think, to compensate for an extra pit stop. That's how I look at it. I mean, Patrick, you're the expert at this stuff. You do it for a living. I mean, what? We know you fought 40, but are you kind of maybe in the same boat now?
Yeah, I mean, the only way that strategy would have worked out is if they caught a caution much later in the race. You know, definitely you want to make sure you do as few stops as possible if it's going to be a long green flag run. So kind of dividing the race 200 laps into four, yet you definitely would want to make that 50-lap mark. But I think depending how the cautions fall, if you do short pit and you get that advantage from a couple laps on fresh tires and then you get a caution later where everybody pits, then that's pretty much the only time that strategy will work out for you.
Meanwhile, back in that battle for the lucky dog position, Mitchell Hunt will take away position from Ray Alfala. So score Alfala now position number 19. Mitchell Hunt will be 18th, and Brad Maher will be in position number 17. Now let's go back up to the track here. The 57 machine getting a little bit of battle here with the number 5, Michael Conti. Conti makes it a quick battle. And Conti will work his way back up to position number 2, but he's got a long way to go before he catches Joey Brown. So now here's where you're going to see it, Tony and Tim. This is where you're going to see if conservation is going to be a thing we're going to see here at Dover International Speedway. Michael Conti, we know, has the car to go out there and chase down Joey Brown. The question is, does he want to?
Conti pitted on the lap 51 caution, so if they go about 40 laps, and Conti almost did go 50 laps, he should be able to go just past the halfway point in this event, as Rob Ackley is slow on the apron. He had damage from that incident with Chad Lawton. He lost the lead lap. He had to come down on the pit road and get service to that race car. Speaking of Chad Lawton, he is back on the racetrack as well in the number 26 car. He just pulled back onto the racetrack. He is 11 laps behind the pace. That is your point leader coming in to this evening's racing action. The 12 and 5, Conti is closing in. We got a battle there between the 69 and I believe that's the 77-88. They're going at it for position 12 down the back straightaway. Barry just passed them, I do believe. Barry is one of those lap down cars, Tony. Now the 77 and 69, that is a battle for position number 12.
It is, Tim, and a good run for Andrew Fiash the third. He's not too far from here. Pocono's more of his home racetrack, but Dover not very far away, so you know it would mean something for him to have a solid run here, and looks like he's going in the right direction. Gets by Peter Bay. Hello, Brian Blackford. Blackford, a slide for life in turn number 3. Hold on to it. That's going to bring out the caution. Second yellow of the day. Blackford just about held on to it, but a couple other drivers got a piece of it as well. Brandon Bowie, the unfortunate soul that ended up running into Brian Blackford, and you can see that one coming, Joe. It was really an unfortunate situation, but three cars in a spot for two is not going to work very well.
The 33 machine of Brian Blackford, he tried to save it. You got to give him a big shout. You got to give him a lot of credit. He wanted to save that one really in an awful, terrible way, but not able to do so. The 33 of Blackford after, it looks like he was forced to check up by the 77 machine, and that allowed the 4 to get underneath him, spinning the 33 around, and despite his best attempts to save it, broke in right in the middle of turn number 4, and that's going to bring out the second caution flag, as a lot of other drivers now got to figure out how they're going to recover from that incident. Brian Blackford, though, he may not recover. That Ford Fusion is down on pit road, heavy smoke out of it, and he's done.
And his teammate was the one that hit him. That was Bowie in the 54, who is ahead of your leaders who are on pit road right now as they try to navigate Bowie. Bowie will head to the pit right there, and it's the 5 of Conti trying to get up along the side of the 12 coming down onto pit road. Conti was reeling him in on that green flag run until the caution flag flew, and now Joey Brown is going to have to hit all of his marks on pit road to make sure he maintains the lead off pit road. Brown comes down to his box, Conti just in front of him. They're going to go with 2 right side tires on the number 12, same deal with the 5. They are down going around to the left-hand side, packing it full of fuel. They'll be down and away momentarily. Ottinger with a quick stop. Is he going to win the race off pit road? No, it's going to be Conti off pit road first. So Conti gets the advantage over the 12 coming off of pit road.
That's the advantage of that number one pit stall, Tim. You qualify on the pole, you get pit stall number one here in the iRacing sim for the NASCAR Pecan Free Series powered by iRacing. And, well, Mike Conti took full advantage of it. Joey Brown's going to have to find a way back around him. And I'll be curious what, if anything, they did do to that 5 car, if they made an adjustment on the first stop, if they undid it or kept it in there, because much like I think I kind of anticipated, that car just got better and better and better as the run went on, and maybe that was the adjustment that they intended to make so the 5 car was better at the end of the run. And Patrick, I have to ask you that... How's that team meeting going to go now? Because two teammates just took each other. Well, I shouldn't say took each other out, because Blackford was involved in the incident and Brandon kind of came sliding in there. But that can't be too good for morale right now.
No, I mean, definitely from a team owner standpoint, that's the worst thing that can happen, is to have two tore up race cars in the same incident. So, things like that, you just got to kind of regroup from them and move on.
Ray Alfala now down on pit road. Mitchell Hunt down on pit road. Kevin King, Cody Bias, Brandon Hawk, Josh Berry, Alex Warren, Brian Day, Alex Scribner, all coming off pit road in the attention of their crews. Justin Bolton, Brad Mehar as well, which answers a big question we've been debating here back and forth, Tony, about the conservation question and the question of, are these guys going to try to make it work and just try to see how long they can drag it out for? The answer is no, but then again, this is a yellow flag, so this could be an anomaly.
And when you look at where we are right now, we're on lap number 85, or working lap number 85, so if these guys can go 40 laps, Tony, do these guys try to stretch it on one more stop, or do we see some of these guys going the two-stop road? Given this thing stays green, of course, if a caution does come out, that's going to throw a whole new wrinkle into these plans. But let's say this thing does go green for debate's sake. Is it one stop or is it two stops?
I vote one stop. I think that's a no-brainer at this point. Because as we saw in the first run, if you stay out for those extra... See, we're going to have 114 laps to go. So that's 57 laps roughly per run. I stay out and make it one stop. Absolutely. We know fuel can go that long. I don't think you can justify going two laps down over the course of two stops versus one. I don't think you can justify going two laps down to try to make it up over the extra 30 laps there. It's next to impossible. The tires don't fall off that much. So I think you have to make it one stop from here, and I think if you're a lap down, your bet's pretty much made right now, and you've got to race for the free pass, pray for a caution flag, and you have to do the one stop strategy. I don't think you can win it on two from here.
Nothing is guaranteed in life, but I've got a feeling one thing is about to be guaranteed. We'll have at least one more caution flag on the field as they come through turns 3 and 4. The first racing Ford Mustang pace car getting the heck out of the way, and now it's in control of Michael Gani once again as he's slow to bring them down as he has the first two restarts. And here we go. Green flag flies. Michael Gani gets the huge jump. Joey Brown, BJ Sturgis flies through it, though, and they are going to get down on the low, and they're going to continue running.
Sturgis wasn't as hot on that restart as he was the last time. He's going to fall to position number 3 behind them. It's a gaggle of cars. Brian Schoenberg may have slapped the wall. He's trying to collect it just in front of them. Busa trying to take a spot away, or check that. That's the 16 and 47 side by side. Lewandowski and Chris Overland. And Overland has made his way into the top 10 for the first time this evening, Tony. Just behind him, Jake Sturgis is way up the racetrack. He's going to lose one to the 39 of Michael Johnson. They all scatter behind them. These guys mean business. They're trying to pick up some spots here early.
Well, hello, Ray Alfala up into the outside safer barrier. He got shoved aside by someone in turn number 3, and there is some damage to that Simpedals Ford. Tough break for Ray Alfala. And looks like he and maybe the 13 of Brad Mehar, I'm hearing, could have come to blows, for lack of a better term. And Joe, it's just gone from bad to worse for pretty much the entire Slip Angle Motorsports team tonight. Byron Daly couldn't make the show because he had some other obligations. Ray Alfalo's event, Brian Blackford is wrecked, Brandon Bowie's wrecked, and for that matter, some of the guys that aren't on their team but up in the point standings, well, they're not having a great night either so far.
That entire situation from the 89 on back, 12 leaves on back, is kind of a hornet's nest right now. They've been running two lines pretty consistently out there for a while. Right now, the highest is in battle position is between the 29 of Kevin King and the 19 of Mitchell Hunt. Even though they're not battling for position, it still creates, they are battling for position, it creates some very dangerous driving. All it takes is one slip here at the track, and not only do you go out, you're going to take a couple out with you. That's for the free pass spot they are battling, and Kevin King seems to have a hold of it now as the 88 of Josh Berry goes down into the inside safer barrier. Josh Berry in a little bit of trouble, and now he's going to join Ray Alfalo licking his wounds at the back of this group.
Yeah, it could have been a lot worse for Josh Berry because that was almost big in front of about half the field as the 88 is going to lose one more spot to the 2 of Ray Alfalo. That should put him back to 24th and about the 8th car that is one lap down as Joey Brown continues to lead up in front with PJ Sturgis, Mike Conti. But the top 5, 8 or so are single file at this point, and then it's around let's say about 18th, 19th place where this thing starts to get hairy. Kevin King has 18th, 19th is Brandon Hawk, and they are side by side with the 69 of Peter Bennett, but I do not believe Bennett is on the lead lap. It's hard to track, Tony, some of these drivers that are on the lead lap and not on the lead lap at this point, where some of these battles for position are.
Yeah, sometimes it is a little hard to track. Usually you can kind of tell because the guys that are a lap down generally are a little bit slower than the guys on the lead lap. But when you have what happened here where a caution comes out in the middle of green flag pit stops, it makes life a little bit more difficult to kind of tell who is and is not on the lead lap. You really have to rely on your scoring monitor and your sense of instinct and memory, for that matter, to keep track of who's where and where everybody's running and where, what situation they're in, for that matter, as to how they can work their way back onto the lead lap and different things like that. Looks like the field's starting to string out. Of course, we had our special guest with us here, Patrick Scarpoli, the 2013 League Stock Car Dream Challenge winner. He had to take off, I guess, and fill some other obligations in his life, but it's been good to have you up here with us, Patrick. I'm sure you probably learned a few things about getting around Dover, at least. Rule number one, though, I think, is don't call a Ray into the outside wall like you did a couple laps ago, though.
Yeah, be some good advice to avoid. But no, it's been a pleasure hanging up in the booth with you guys and getting to watch this race from a bird's eye view, and hopefully come back and do it again with you here soon.
We certainly hope to have you back anytime. You're welcome here in the PSR-TV booth, as we can always use the advice of somebody that makes us look smart, which is very hard to do because you're the smart one of the group right now, and we just kind of all take to that. Nonetheless, good luck on some of the things you got rolling, and we look forward to keeping track of you on Twitter and Facebook. Where all can everybody keep track of Patrick Scarpoli and everything you got going on now as the inaugural winner of the Peak Stock Car Dream Challenge?
Yeah, you can follow along with all the stuff we have going on. We got a new website this year with a bunch of nice updated content on it. So patrickstarpoli.com. And also 97 Patrick Star on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Got a ton of updates, so we got a lot going on. Everybody just stay tuned and see what we're going to do next.
Well, Joe, that's Patrick Scarpoli. Again, great to have him up here, but it looks like things are starting to pick up just a little bit on the racetrack, Joe. It looks like the strategy element may be starting to come into play with some of these guys, as I don't see a lot of guys doing anything crazy yet.
Top 10 have pretty much settled out. Being the top 11 is pretty much settled out. But the one guy, the two guys that are really starting to turn it up out here are the 29 of Kevin King and the 19 of Mitchell Hunt. These guys have been chasing each other all throughout the track. And now Kevin King, trying to get around the 13 of Brad Mehar, does so very efficiently. Kevin King looks like he wants to get his lap back the hard way. And Mitchell Hunt, I think he cares less about getting the lap back and more about getting that lucky dog position away from the 29.
That last lap was halfway on the 12 of Joey Brown. We have 100 laps completed and 100 laps to go. It's over. Brown will lead PJ Sturgis by a half second. Michael Conti is closing in on the 57. Nick Ottinger and Matt Busa, your top five. Great to see Busa in the top five at this point, and he is actually leading Danny Hansen for that spot in position number 6. So Danny Hansen the first-time winner from 2 weeks ago, still in the mix. In this one, we have 17 drivers on the lead lap at the halfway point in this event. So far, so good for this race. We've seen some green flag running, Tony, and it looks like at this point, it looks like we have some green flag racing still to accomplish. The battle for the free pass spot appears to be intriguing right now, though. That is the 29 and the 19 running in 18th and 19th, respectively. And they also have Brandon Hawk running just behind them in position number 20. Got a three-way dance for position at number 18 in the free pass.
Yeah, I never thought when you come to Dover, you'd say the best battle on the racetrack would be for 18th, and it would be the one that would have all of our attention, but at the moment, it really does, and deservedly so. I mean, Kevin King, I think, could be a threat to win if he gets on the lead lap. Mitchell Hunt, same thing, if he gets on the lead lap. Cody Bias, Brian Day, even Ray Alfala, of course, could be a threat to win if he can get back on the lead lap. And Joe, today that's been a lot easier said than done. Other than that first caution flag, it seems like the caution flags are not falling in the right places. The competition for that free pass spot gets a little bit more heated each and every lap. It's to the point that, you know, you almost don't want to be in the free pass spot because it seems like that's when something happens to you.
You got a point there, and that's definitely a kind of a jinx spot right now. Maybe an unlucky spot, if you will, as these guys continue to run. Very quick lap times out here, about 22.75 seconds around your top 10 as well. These guys running as quick as they feel like running out of here. And 22 is about average, I'd say, for this kind of for this track, for this mile-long oval at
Dover. It's
better
you can turn, Joe.
That's a lot better than I can do. Let's be honest about it.
So there you go. That's it.
Well, but that's, if you start using me as a racing barometer, then you're point of reference is going to get skewed very, very quickly. Let's just be honest about it.
Joe, you're also talking about a former iRacing Daytona 500 winner in Tony Stevens, so I don't think you're going to win that battle. Speaking of battles, though, the 29 and 19...
Hey, Tim, it was a 759th split. It's okay.
Yeah, okay. I won a late model race at one point back in my iRacing career, too. But the 19 of Mitchell Hunt is closing in on Kevin King once again for that free pass spot. They did catch Michael J. Johnson. You saw that in the 39. 53 caught him in a very bad place off of corner number 2. He's closed back in now, and here comes the 19 on the number 29. We have 17 cars in lead lap. The battle for 18th, Tony, you mentioned it earlier, maybe the best battle because it's a three-way dogfight, and they're closing up on Brian Schoenberg right now, and that is position number 9. So it's not only are these guys battling for 18th, they're quick. They're turning top 10 lap times. They're battling within the top 10. They're just not scored on the same lap.
And really, it's unfortunate, and I think these guys realize that right now, and they're having to try to play that game in their head. You don't want to be the caution flag right now that even that you do need, because then, wait, never mind, so that's one car on pit road. Brian Blackford went bouncing off the wall in the pit lane. I thought that he was on the racetrack momentarily. But no, you don't want to be that caution, and I think, Joe, it seems like the field is, the look of these race cars looks a lot different now. Almost like everybody is in conservation mode, trying to get to that halfway mark of this run where they can make one pit stop and not have to worry about being so out of control in those last 15 laps or so.
I absolutely concur, but I also believe that some of these guys may be forced into making that pit stop and making that pit stop probably sooner rather than later. For case in point, the 19 of Mitchell Hunt, a couple laps ago, he made brief contact with the outside wall coming off of turn number 2. Got dangerously close to doing it again a couple laps ago, and now Mitchell Hunt might be seeing what happens when these multi-zone tires start to go down, when these multi-zone tires start to wear off. You start to see what exactly happens and how much harder it is to manage this car with older tires. If you need to get past the fact for a moment that they're not as fast on the older rubbers, the biggest thing that you gotta remember is they don't handle nearly as well on the older tires. That makes it very difficult for these guys to try to put together that strategy to make that passes, make everything work out there. And so you might see a couple drivers here being forced as opposed to willing the car into making that extra run.
19 tried it on the number 29 of Kevin King as he was fighting with the 55 of Schoenberg. 19 backs off a little bit 29 to the inside of the 55, and he's not going to cut him any slack as well. 29 moves in, 19 trying to move in, and 53 of Brandon Hawk also going to try to make the pass in the 55 of Brian Schoenberg. And Schoenberg is going to lose one spot here, because here comes the 39 of Michael Johnson, going to lose one more to the 13 of Brad Maher. And the 55 car just got passed by five cars, Tony. Two of them were for position, and here he comes, crossover on the 13, trying to get at least one of them back.
Yeah, I think, Tim, that was by design, just so he could let those guys go that were racing for the free pass spot. Worry about running his race, race the racetrack, and not the guys in front of him. A long time ago, that probably, wouldn't have been Brian Schoenberg. I think we would have probably seen an incident there, but like a lot of drivers that make it to this level, Joe, Brian Schoenberg has matured his driving, making smarter decisions, and that's why he's in the top 10 in points. Running now in the top 10 with probably a sub-top 10 race car, but he's doing the best in the circumstances he's been given, and that's what wins championships and keeps you in fights for titles like he's in right now.
This is a strategy track. This is a track where you play chess the entire way around, and every move you make, every approach you make, every pit stop you make matters. Every one of those counts towards how you're ultimately going to play the game at the end of the race. And now you're really starting to figure out how it's going to make it, how it's all coming together. Now you're really starting to see what everything happens. But the biggest wild card that has yet to be played is that pit strategy. When do these guys pit? How do these guys pit? And more importantly, where are they going to be able to make it to that halfway point? As I said a minute ago, I think some of these guys are going to be forced to come in earlier, though nobody shows any indication of making that happen.
And we're hearing 143-ish is around the magic number, thereabouts, for possible pit stops to the end of this race. And that splits it in half, according to what Tony says. And Joey said earlier that he's smarter than us. I think that's what he said. So that's
I'm pretty sure
that's what you said earlier. So
Ottinger's
going to lose a spot to the 05 of Ottinger.
Never mind.
Ottinger to the inside, going to pick up position number 3, and Conti going to fall back to position number 4. Now you guys can debate.
No, I just think Staropoli makes us look smart because he raises the company that we're in. You know what I'm saying? It's you're judged by the company you keep, and it's when it's us three clowns, we're just nobody. When you put somebody like that here, you know, it makes us look good.
Joe, what he's trying to say is now we're clowns.
I said us clowns. I didn't say you clowns. I said us clowns. I get up.
It looks like Ottinger's closing in, though, on our second-place driver is to 26 at Chad Lawton. Goes one more lap down, but a tough night for Lawton, as he will move back a couple of spots to 5 of Michael Conti. Will motor pass at number 26, and that is your battle for the point lead at this point. And right now, it's a one-sided battle as Conti is 4th, and Chad Lawton scored 11 laps down in position number 32 right now. So, Tony, that's a lopsided battle at this point. The third-place driver in the standings, Jake Sturgis, he may very well pick up 2nd in the standings. He's sitting 12th. And Nick Ottinger, well, he's running up in the top 5 as well, running in 3rd. So this is it's going to be very exciting with the fact that the 26 is not having the night that he wanted.
Yeah, I think you're right, Tim. And it might be a drop race maybe for Chad Lawton here at Dover. I guess it's a good place to maybe expect to use one, but certainly not his night. The other thing I'm looking at now is we thought Mike Conti might be making his way through the field. And well, yes, he's closing in on P.J. Sturgis and trying to close in on Joey Brown, but I think it's a surprise, but not a surprise at the same time, Joe, that here we are getting down to crunch time, and look who's moving their way forward. It's Nick Ottinger, the Ream Toyota, making his way to the front of the field. In fact, now vying for that 2nd spot underneath the P.J. Sturgis, he'll take it and set his sights on Joey Brown. I think Conti might, I don't know what they did to that race car, but something is not the same, or Joey Brown and everybody around him really stepped their game up to outwit, outsmart, and outdrive that number 5 machine of Conti.
Am I okay to give an opinion there, a wise one?
Oh, I give up. You know what? I give up with you two. I just give up with you two.
Funny you mentioned the 05 of Nick Ottinger. His team must be listening as he inherits now position number 2. His team just sent out a tweet. Still out here flying, #NPass, #iRacing. So they know that Nick Ottinger has a good car, and this is the strategy I was talking about earlier in this race. Nick Ottinger has found that strategy to work for him. He's found this second life in these tires out here, and now he doesn't have to run as incredibly fast. He doesn't have to run incredibly hard. All he has to do is run clean, wait for Joey Brown to make the pit stop, and then the race for the race will begin.
And it looks like Ottinger was about a tenth quicker. Two laps ago, he was tenths quicker. That last time by the 29, and Kevin King is down on the pit road. Mitchell Hunt also on pit road. This is where the pit stops will begin. You mentioned that, I believe it was 143 mark, Tony, but we are in 40 laps of this run. We started about lap 85, and now we are starting to be within that 40-lap window that some of these guys were talking about. So some of these drivers opting to come down to pit road just after that 40-lap mark, since we had the pit stop, the caution flag, and went back to the green flag. Joey Brown continues to lead this race. Ottinger, Sturgis, Conti, and Busa, top five on the racetrack, completing 130.
And I think, Tim, if you come down pit road right now, your race is pretty much over. There's no shot of having a victory unless you catch the caution flags right. For instance, Kevin King just came down pit road. He now going to be a few laps down. Looks like Mitchell Hunt just came down pit road. He's going to be a few laps down. You've got to make it a one-stop deal on this run, in my opinion, to have any shot of salvaging the race the way you want it to turn out. The difference between now and lap, what was it, 143, I think we figured? It's 13, 14 laps. Total of 30 laps over two runs. You cannot make up two laps over the course of 30 laps. The tires are not going to fall off that much. So I think Kevin King and Mitchell Hunt just made their bed to finish mediocre in this race, to be completely honest with you. I don't agree with the call, but you know what? I'm not on their pit box right now, Joe. It might just be what they absolutely have to do.
Well, that's a very educated opinion, Tony Stevens. I certainly appreciate that insight. Meanwhile,
You know what, Joe? I'm just going to be referred to right here as the great one, and I'm going to act it from here on out, because, you know, if you're just going to give me that mass respect, I might as well just take it.
We're not worthy. One driver that is worthy, though, is Landon Harrison, currently running 15th out there. Let's take a peek at his webcam as he continues to run out here. Apparently, Landon Harrison is a threat to win this race. You know why, guys? Because he's got a clean car. He's still on the lead lap, and all it takes is that right set of pit stops in order for him to get out there and make his move towards the end of this race. This is the strategy I keep talking about, guys. This is what you're seeing it play out. Clean cars, good tires, you can run all day here at the Monster.
Jordan Hightower explained the run of the 89 earlier to me as galloping walrus fever again this week. They had that at Charlotte, they have it here apparently at Dover, and apparently it's paying off for what could very well be a top 15 finish at this point. He caught that caution right the last time we had that caution in the middle of green flag pit stops. He's looking at Scribner right now. Scribner, I do not think, is on the same lap as he. Ray Alfala is definitely not on the same lap as Landon Harrison. He passes the two car. And it looks like there's a couple of drivers here that are on differing strategies. Speaking about the lead, the 05 of Ottinger has caught the 12 of Joey Brown. And that is the battle for the lead, about two car lengths or so between your top two. They have driven away from the rest of the field, and Ottinger drives it down into corner number three, and he will take the lead away from Joey Brown. No contest. Ottinger is just flat flying here on 137. The later the run goes, looks like Ottinger's just that little bit better.
And now we are seeing some of the leaders come down pit road as well. You saw Danny Hansen in the box there just a moment ago. He's come down pit road. I don't know if I mean, you're close to that window, so I think you can make it if you're pitting now. You're getting closer, but it's a big risk, I'm telling you. And I think we're going to see Ottinger on pit road here in just a little bit. Brad Mehar is on pit road. Cody Bias is a lap down and then some now. Also on pit road, but I don't think we're going to see our leaders on pit road for at least another four or five laps. Joe, is now they're encountering a little bit of traffic. Ray Alfala immediately in front of the leaders. Well, now immediately alongside and behind the leaders. He goes another lap down. Joey Brown starting to work his way by Stevie Gilbert. As it looks like you can see a second and a half roughly versus new tires. That's a pretty big jump, but I don't see that working out for you.
Let's take a look real quick at that pass again. The 05 and Nick Ottinger got around the 12 of Joey Brown. About the time he made that pass, his team once again get on Twitter here, kitty, 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 they can't say to Joey Brown, as Nick Ottinger looking for his second win of the season. The yellow flag said, in the words of Rusty Wallace, GF Racing 05 is flat flying out there. That, of course, being Nick Ottinger's Twitter handle out there for all of you listening at home wanting to get along Twitter. Joe and Nick Ottinger now in control of this race, and he's there starting to get a breakaway on the rest of this field. But Ottinger is going to need some tires in a hurry. So is Joey Brown. And look who's up there in the mix now. Kevin King, three laps down, but he's got new tires on that machine, and he's going to try to keep himself in contention one way or another.
Yeah, the 29 the last time by 22.83 to Nick Ottinger's 23.75. So there's a good second between those two as the 29 tries to navigate the 05 to get one of his three laps back. Rayal Fallo overshot his pit box. He had to back up, and he's going to lose some more time as he goes back out onto the racetrack. Kevin King disposes of the 05, and Ottinger, up the racetrack he goes, and almost into traffic for the 05 of Ottinger. Ottinger trying to hold on. He may have to come down to pit road here very shortly.
This is the magic lap, Tim. We talked about, hello, Joey Brown! He'll slap the fence coming into the pit lane, or at least come awfully doggone close. But this is the magic lap we talked about, splitting the pit strategy into two equal runs of 57 laps. Ottinger and Brown are on the strategy. Matt Busa, Brian Schoenberg, they're staying on the racetrack for the time being. Same with Jake Sturgis, and he's been known to make an economy run or two in his day, but it doesn't matter for the time being, because now Ottinger, four tires and fuel, going to be the call on the ream machine. They'll finish service on his Toyota. He'll be down and away. Same with Joey Brown. Looks like minimal, if any, damage to that number 12 car and his machine as well. Going to be down and away momentarily. Looks like Ottinger is going to win the race between those two. Off of the pit lane is now Matt Busa on pit road, Joe.
The 34 of Matt Busa, he got an extra point from leading a lap. Now he's going to come down to the attention of his crew. Look for the same thing for him. Four tires, full tank of fuel for that 34 machine. The 30 of Robert Hall coming in behind him as well, looking for the same exact thing. The 77 of Andrew Fash down on pit road. And now the 55 of Brian Schoenberg is going to be on pit road, it looks like.
The 41 of Jake Sturgis is your leader, and Jake Sturgis missed pit road two laps ago. He was coming down into pit road, nearly smoked the barrels, and now he is, going to get into the 30, and that's a save. They're going to get back onto the racetrack, and the 41 now is going to come down onto pit road, and he is going to get onto pit road at least this time, but he's going to have a little bit of damage.
Yeah, Tim, he was trying to get to the bottom there and didn't see Robert Hall coming or didn't anticipate him being there. I thought for a moment Sturgis might be making an economy run. He was kind of throwing the clutch in and drifting around each end of the speedway, but at this point it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to try that. You know you can make it either way, and was starting to kind of wonder there about his strategy, but I guess it doesn't matter now. Four tires and fuel for the MX machine, and his Chevy SS will be down and away, and once everything cycles back out, look who's up front. Mike Conti in the number 5 machine, but he is in heavy, heavy traffic. But for that matter, look who's ahead of him. Kevin King, Mitchell Hunt, they're now on the tail end of the lead lap. If they can catch a caution rather quickly, this pit strategy will work for them.
Interestingly though, look who's now leading the field. The guy who was leading the field so dominantly all night, the driver of that 5 machine, Michael Conti. He's got along 2 seconds on Nick Ottinger and Joey Brown, and Michael Conti's already come down for his service on the Abuto Gaming Caucus machine, I believe. So now, here's a very interesting thing. Can Conti hold on and almost double reverse play this race in double reverse, and ultimately win this race? Yes, he's got to go 60 laps, but with a little bit of tire conservation, anything is possible. That's really going to frustrate the guys on Twitter for Gale Force Racing and Lastro Motorsports.
And I'm sure it's going to frustrate the 05's Twitter a little more, because one of the LRM cars just passed him and is pulling away. Joey Brown is pulling away from Nick Ottinger in the 05 car. So, but we saw it on that run. Nick Ottinger, it looked like he was a little bit better from about lap 40 to lap 60 or so on that run, or lap 40 to 50, I should say, on that run. That run was 57 laps for Nick Ottinger. But lap 40 to 50, Ottinger was better than everybody else on that run, and then it fell off on lap 50 as opposed to about lap 40 or so that everybody else is falling off of. So if we do go green to the end of the race, guys, Nick Ottinger's got a good piece. It's just a matter if he can catch up to Mike Conti or if Conti saves anything. He's got to go longer on this run than Nick Ottinger does. I don't think Conti might come down pit road, but as you mentioned, Tony, I don't think he can really risk it at this point to go that two-stop strategy. He leads by 1.8 seconds over Joey Brown, and it looks like among the top three, that 12 car might be the quickest in the trio.
But this is what we saw the last run. We saw Joey jump out, and then we saw, like you said, Ottinger start to reel him back in. And I think that's the winning strategy as the race stands now. Again, a lot of this is done in the shop or in the garage, so to speak. And just like the physical world, where racers are won and lost in the shop, or I should say won in the shop, or they can be lost on the racetrack, same deal. This race, I think, has been won in the shop, so to speak, in testing, in the setup, as opposed to on the racetrack. Could it be lost on the racetrack? Absolutely. But I think Ottinger right now is the best poised to be in a good position coming into this race. In fact, I think he's almost a little confident behind the wheel, Joe. The last tweet out of the 05 bunch, winning.
That was before they made the pit stops. That was before Joey Brown made the pass. And now Joey Brown's team, Laster Motorsports, responded back to Gale Force winning, Gale Force Racing. Here, kitty. So the war of words, the race of the words, is happening now on Twitter. You can follow along using the hashtags NPAS or iRacingWCS. And almost as entertaining as a race we see here on track is the race on Twitter between Last Row Motorsports and Gale Force Racing out there. It makes for some very entertaining augmented reality, if you will. We're augmenting augmented reality. It's kind of a Inception moment there, guys.
And up in front, the top three, about status quo. Michael Conti, this time behind, puts in a 22.71. Joey Brown's 22.89. And Nick Ottinger's 22.79. So those lap times within a tenth or so between your top three. PJ Sturgis runs in fourth. He's got about five car lengths or so on Danny Hansen in the 32. Busa, Oberlin, Maher, Lewandowski, Bennett, Schoenberg, and Johnson are the only 12 cars right now on the lead lap. Michael Johnson is exiting corner number two, and it looks like your leader is about to exit to here, so about a straightaway or so between your leader and the next driver to go one lap down. So it looks like it's starting to take its toll here, Tony, with 12 cars remaining on the lead lap.
Yeah, it certainly has. Pit stops, and of course that yellow flag on the opening round of pit stops really kind of set the tone over the course of the night as far as how many cars we will have on the lead lap. Position changing further back in the field. You saw Brian Day and Andrew Fias in the third. They're all one lap down. And really, you look from 13th all the way down to 26th. That's a third of the field one lap down. In fact, there are more cars one lap down than they're on the lead lap right now. That's how much of a curveball has been thrown to these teams. You look further back to the field, and really 32nd through about 37th is out of the race. So over half of the field still running, being scored one lap down. And that's good news if you're a Mike Conti, a Joey Brown, anybody on the lead, the opening half of the lead lap right now, because of the fact that if something even goes wrong, Joe, you've got a little bit of cushion to still have a decent run tonight, I think.
Well, that cushion may go away, though, if a caution flag comes out. Right now, everybody kind of holding their breath on the track, you know, thinking, you know, all it takes is one car getting into that outside wall. All it takes is one car getting the inside safer barrier for this thing to go under yellow flag and have a bunch up one more time with less than 40 to go. So, guys, this is really all contingent on if we're going to have a good, clean race out here, and contingent on how everybody decides to handle their cars out there.
Looking at this battle with the 77 of Andrew Fayash the third, that's Landon Harrison to the upside. That is a battle for position, 18th and 19th. Steven Gilbert not on the same lap. Adam Gilliland is on the same lap as the 89 and the 77. So,
trouble
into the fence
track
on the front straightaway.
The 37. And this is going to be a 37 of Steven Gilbert getting out of line off turn number four. And this can be no caution, though. Steven Gilbert all self-spins, hits the inside safer barrier hard on the front stretch. No caution, though. We keep racing.
It's almost like something broke, Tim. He just in the middle of the straightaway turned left. That was kind of odd.
Yeah, I didn't see any sort of contact there between any sort of driver. It looked like there might have been some sort of contact or something broke, but there definitely wasn't any contact, at least on the monitor that I'm looking at, Tony. But Stephen Gilbert hard into the fence. He was already three laps down. I believe he just fell a fourth lap down because of that incident. So a tough break for them. And that's what happens when those guys are battling at it for those positions. The 05 and the 12 are going at it now for position number two.
And they're in traffic, heavy traffic. Chad Lawton in the middle of that. Kevin Keane, who just went a lap down again to leader Mike Conti, is right in front of him. And you've got the Gilbert car, who we just spoke of, way up the racetrack ahead of Joey Brown. He'll give plenty of room to the leaders. It looks like they'll get through without any sort of incident. But you know that right now, Nick Ottinger closing in on the 200-lap mark, Joe. 34 laps to go this time. And that gap between Joey Brown, Nick Ottinger, and Mike Conti, it's not changing. Let me back up. It's not shrinking. It's going the opposite direction. Maybe Mike Conti has lured everybody into a false sense of security here. I mean, yeah, 33 laps or so is still a long time to go, Joe, but he might be onto something right now.
Well, I think, again, playing the race in double reverse out there might have benefited Michael Conti, and Michael Conti's no stranger to the sim. He's got a few wins under his belt. He's got a couple seasons under his belt, so Conti could very easily be looking at something here that nobody else thought of at Dover International Speedway. He continues to run. He continues to run hard out here, and now he's got well over 3.5 seconds on Joey Brown, Nick Ottinger, and company. Now let's play devil's advocate here a little bit. Maybe the 12 and the 05 stop their little feud on Twitter. Maybe the both of them now are sitting here trying to figure out what they can do to work together and ultimately get up to and challenge the 5 for the win. The problem is, though, they don't have a whole lot of time. If they're going to start making some moves, you got to quit playing conservation mode and start making some moves.
Here's what I'm looking at, guys. You look at the 05 of Nick Ottinger on that last round. We mentioned around lap 40 to 50 or so. He was a little bit better than his competition. You look at Mike Conti. He's short pitted compared to a guy like Nick Ottinger. And we see these tires really fall off the cliff, per se, after lap 40 or so. They're closing in on that point. The 05 is going to be a little bit quicker, at least if the last run is any indication, than the number 5 of Mike Conti. There's 3.3 seconds. We're closing in. We're just under 30 laps to go now. I think Nick Ottinger, if that does come back, he may be able to make that 3 seconds up on Mike Conti. But he's got to get past Joey Brown at the same time. He's probably got to get past some traffic too, Tony. So it's an uphill battle for Nick Ottinger. But if those other guys fall off the cliff, Ottinger may still be on the mountain after this thing's over if we do stay green.
That's a big if, Tim, if we stay green. In fact, right now, Mike Conti mired in traffic. He's got a car he just worked his way by. That's Brandon Hawk in the RacerBoost.com entry. Trey Eisen immediately in front of him as well. And it looks like he might know. To try to get by him this time, but can't get the job done. Eisen a lap down, trying to stay one lap down ahead of Mike Conti, and this is giving Conti fits. You've got to know it behind the wheel of his machine, because he just about got into Eisen, and now he's going to lay the bumper to him in turn number two. Mike Conti getting a little bit frustrated with Trey Eisen. He knows that this is valuable time he's losing to Joey Brown. The gap has gone from 3.5 seconds, Joe, down to 2.5 seconds, and we anticipate that Brown's going to have better tires at the end of this run. Mike Conti, this could be a race-changing situation he has now found himself in.
0.8 of a second difference that time for Joey Brown. Joey Brown cutting into the gap of Michael Conti. If I'm the spotter of the number 5 right now, that Abudo Gaming Cockpit machine, I'm telling him, don't panic. Whoa. Even though he lays the bumper to the 6 once again. Conti, I don't think he's panicking per se, but he is in full out attack mode now. He will not lose this race to lap traffic as a 6 of 53 creating a chicane behind him. 1.1 seconds last time by. The difference between Michael Conti and Joey Brown. Joey Brown is on the hunt. This is going to be an ending for the ages. 24 to go.
Yeah, keep in mind that the 12 gained about a second and a half on those last two laps alone, and now the 6 just pulls over for the 12. The six is not on the same team. As far as I know, he was a part of Cody Bias Racing last week. Now, that could have changed, Tony, but the six held up the five. I don't know if there's any history there. He might hold up the 05 a little bit here. No, he's going to roll over for him as well. I don't know if there's any history between Trey and Michael Conti or Cody Bias Racing and Jay Show Motorsports, but it just cost Mike Conti about a second and a half and about two laps. It's not the prerogative. The lap car does not have to pull over, but it's one of the nice things to do, and I'm sure Mike Conti's going to remember that in the future.
Yeah, I think so, and I agree 100%, Tim. You're not obligated to move for anybody on the racetrack. It's the courteous thing to do, and with 30 laps, 25 laps to go, and you're already a lap down, about to go two laps down, yeah, you probably should, out of respect, move over, but you're not obligated to move over. But it almost looked like to me that Eidson was making every effort to impede the progress of Mike Conti. There's only one person that really knows for sure what happened in that six car, and he'll never probably tell us the truth. Maybe he will, but it certainly has played into this race, Joe, and now what was a very comfortable lead for Mike Conti is anything but. Joey Brown crosses the stripe, less than a second now behind Mike Conti. 19 laps to go next time by. Joey Brown and Nick Ottinger both closing in on Michael Conti. This is going to be a three-way fight for the Monster Mile Trophy here this evening.
Everybody wants a piece of Miles in the worst way out here as the battle starts to heat up. Michael Conti continuing in his lead, but his lead getting cut by about a tenth of a second every time by, though. Nick Ottinger, second and a half away. Nick Ottinger, don't count him out yet, but Nick Ottinger's got to start thinking what he wants to do, how he wants to do it, and what makes the most logical sense for him to do. Joey Brown in the catbird seat, as they say. It's Michael Conti in the catbird seat. Either way, both those drivers have something to prove in the closing laps here at Dover.
2 tenths that time by, exactly. Joey Brown cut off Mike Conti's lead. It's now about 7 tenths of a second, and we talked about that cliff with the tires. I think Mike Conti's tires may have just fallen off it. It's just a matter of how wide Mike Conti can make his car in these remaining 16 laps or so. Oh, three car on the fence in front of the leaders. We stay green, but the three car, oh boy. That's not the way Brandon Schmidt wanted to end his night.
No, it wasn't, and that was almost disastrous, Tim, for the leaders, as Schmidt still fighting to get that car under control as he gets to pit road, and that was almost all she wrote for the top three. Kind of reminds me of the incident that involved Ray Alfala here last year that, ultimately cost him a championship, as there's still some tight battles going on around the racetrack. Josh Berry just shoved his way by Danny Hansen, nearly made contact. Brian Day in the same boat. We're going to have a lot of comers and goers here, Joe. A lot of cars on old tires, a lot of cars on new tires. As it looks like up front, Joey Brown going to get underneath Mike Conti for the top spot.
Coming and going's the right way to put it. Here comes Joey Brown. There goes Michael Conti. Conti also now about to get passed by the 05 of Nick Ottinger. So Ottinger turning on the overdrive. And very entertaining. Two Chevys and a Toyota all battling for the win. Inside 20 to go, inside 15 to go for that matter. Joey Brown, 2/10 of a second over Nick Ottinger right now. But Ottinger looking like he's going to try to drive the tires off that Toyota Camry, physically and literally, as he tries to catch a 12 of Joey Brown.
They lap the 37 of Stephen Gilbert. The 05 is closing in on the 12. As you see the battle for fourth, being Sturgis and Busa in the box, but the 05 is closing in. The 05 is pretty much there. It's 2/10, two car lengths or so between your top two positions going down the back straightaway, as Conti has fallen off the cliff and fallen off badly. And Tony, when you look back at it between he and Trey, that may not have been the difference anyway. Yes, he may have used a little bit of his tires, but right now he's over a second behind your top two, second and a half there. He just lost a second and a half in about three laps that he lost in two laps on the lead earlier.
Yeah, and that car, Tim, you watch that Abutto Gaming Cockpit's car, and it's a handful. It's almost like there's a flat tire on the car. That's how out of control it is. Mike Conti might be fighting to stay even on the podium if things continue as they're currently going. He lost another half a second that time, and another 4/10 to the guys behind him. So Mike Conti's day has gone from great to good to great again, and now from not so great to getting worse by the lap. But not what he wanted by any means. Is now the leaders, Joe, in traffic. 10 laps to go this time. I don't know if Joey Brown can hold off Nick Ottinger, but there are going to be plenty of chances for both of them to screw it up right here.
So says the smartest man in the booth. The 82 is going to get out of the way. The 39 is going to get out of the way. Now the battle will be between the 12 and the 05. This is what we live for. Here in the booth, 9 to go when they cross the start-finish line. The 05 starting to have some electrical issues. Can he hold on for 9 more laps? But more importantly, can the 12 hold him off for 9 more laps? 12 strong in the turns, but back on the back stretch. The 05 all over the back of the 12. He's underneath the 05 for the lead.
05 of Ottinger to the inside of the 12 of Joey Brown. Brown trying to hold off the 05 contact. He goes around and into the fence in the front straightaway. 23 of Brandon Hoff helping around this. We'll bring up the caution. We're going to have a restart with about 4 laps to go. This changes everything. And Joey Brown, front and rear damage to that race car. And he tried to hold onto it to the outside line. Tony could not do it. And then he got loose and the 23 kind of helped him around. He was already gone anyway, though.
Yeah, I think Nick probably could have gained a little more room there, but you're down to under 10 to go. I mean, you don't cut anybody a lot of breaks at this point. And I guess that's racing. Joey Brown's not going to be happy. I'll tell you who is going to be happy, though. Mike Conti. I think everybody's going to be on pit road here, guys. 4 tires, maybe some fuel, probably not any fuel. 4 tires, and manhandle it for all it's worth. So if you're Mike Conti, you come in, you take 4 skins. You're Nick Ottinger, you come in, you take 4 tires. If you're a Brad Mehar or a Denny Hansen or a Peter Bennett, do you A, stay out, Joe, and hope for a quick yellow to try to steal one, or maybe take 2 tires? I think if you're in the lead here, you might be a sitting duck because somebody is going to take a risk. I just don't know who.
I'm still looking at this replay, guys, and I'm trying to figure out what exactly happened between the 12 and the 05. I'm trying to figure out if the 05 came up from the apron or if the 12 just got stuck in that unfortunate turn 4 position where he overdrove it. Back down in the on pit road, everybody coming down, the attention of their crews. The one guy that stayed out, I believe, the 57 of Sturgis.
LRM stays out on the racetrack. DJ Sturgis, Chris Overland, everybody else on the lead lap is on pit road. Michael Johnson will get the free pass on this caution flag. Ottinger, it looks like, is going to take 4 tires for the Ream Toyota, as he will be down and away, and we'll see if he wins the race off pit road, Tony.
This could be the race off pit road to determine it. Left side just going up on Conti's car, so yes. Looks like Ottinger will win the battle off pit road. Mike Conti will be the second. But the question is, will they have a chance to get by PJ Sturgis and Chris Overland? They stayed out, and just like we talked about, guys, maybe not so much PJ Sturgis. That's kind of a surprise because he was in the top 5. And he might end up worse for wear after this, but Chris Overland was deep inside the deep down in the lead lap cars. He really had nothing to lose, Joe. I don't think I blame Chris Overland for staying out by any means. Take what you've gotten, pray it works, and maybe your situation will be better. But I think PJ Sturgis might be the loser once this is all played out, or maybe we get a quick caution, and you know, who knows? PJ Sturgis could steal him one.
Let's take a look at that battle off pit road real quick as we look at the 5 and 05. Continue to just run on the track. These two drivers are going to be the ones to watch as everyone gets ready to roll the dice at Dover.
Getting ready for a 5-lap dash to the finish. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
What's inside peak antifreeze? 65 years of experience in hot and cold protection. From an independent, family-owned business that's never been afraid to give you exactly what's right for your engine and your wallet. Peak. Run true.
Well, glad you could join us for the final 5 laps of this event. We are working lap 196 right now. We are probably going to have a restart with 3 laps to go. The question is that 3 laps too many for PJ Sturgis and the 47 of Chris Overland? They stayed out on the racetrack. Nick Ottinger, the 5 of Michael Conti, Matt Busa, Danny Hansen, Brian Schoenberg, Peter Bennett, Tom Lewandowski, Brad Maher, albeit Joey Brown has more of a shortened up race car than a Sprint Cup Series car. He is on the lead lap. Michael J. Johnson and Jake Sturgis being scored on the lead lap as well. Jake Sturgis, one of the Sturgis brothers, did not come in because he's going to receive the wave around, but he is going to be back in 13th place. Everybody else on the lead lap, Tony, came down pit road except for your top two. Lights are out atop the pace car. This is going to be big in one way or the other.
Yes, I'm not sure which way it's going to be big, but this is going to be entertaining. You don't want to miss these three laps. They're going to be some of the most exciting laps, hopefully, we've seen all season long. Certainly one of the most impending and absolutely imperatively important restarts all day, all season long, for that matter. So many contenders up front, and this is Dover, Joe. Something crazy could happen. We've seen it. Somebody spins the tires in the restart, takes out six guys in the lead lap, and then somebody else gets by them to win the race. This could be large, either in the sense of an accident or the sense of what actually happens with the racing on the racetrack. Remember, if the caution flag comes out, this race is over. PJ Sturgis and Chris Overland both looking for the upset with 3 miles left to go in Dover.
It's going to be a green-white checkered finish, or at least for the one attempt at one here at Dover. Green-white checkered, I should say, as Chris Overland, PJ Sturgis, hesitant to get on the gas. They are dragging their heels down pit road.
Oh,
and the 0-5 gets loose. The 0-5 gets loose after the push from the 34. This is not going to end well for everybody, anybody. Meanwhile, the 32 gets spun. 32 gets spun into the traffic. Big, big trouble. Let's go follow the lead for the win.
And Mike Conti rolled the top around the outside of PJ Sturgis. He is scored as your leader, as far as we know. And Mike Conti, if he can come around for two more laps, should be the winner of this thing. Tony, I believe the five was ahead at the time of caution. They were all wrecking behind them, and I believe Conti rolled the top just far enough to take away the victory in this one. And it looks like Sturgis isn't passing him back under this caution. So it looks like the five may have won this race as the 57 pulls up to the inside. Tough break for Sturgis and Overland. They did exactly what they had to do. They brought the field down slow. Ottinger tried to jump that start. You saw him all over the back bumper. He spun the tires. He gets involved, or he got hit in the 05, is going to finish in fourth. But Ottinger was pushing the leader down the front straightaway out of turn number four, so he was anticipating something that didn't happen in Sturgis going early.
Yeah, I mean, they brought him down slowly and eased into the gas, which kind of stacked everybody up, and it's really a product of the situation we were in. We knew something was going to happen. I think all of us expected that to happen, to be completely honest with you. Just the nature of what happens when two guys with ancient tires and are a second and a half slower start at the front of the field. But I can't blame either of them now, because look where they're at. Mike Conti, he's going to be happy as the first two-time winner this season. You have PJ Sturgis, who improved where he was at. He came in, or stayed out, I should say, from what, fifth spot. He'll finish second. Chris Overland, who was running 11th, going to finish third. Can't say it was a bad gamble for him, Joe.
Guys, I'm just still flabbergasted by that restart we had, and I'm not exactly sure how that all took place. The 47 looks like he just lost the position, let the 43 do the check up. The 34 was in no mood to check up, and that just causes a chain reaction through the field. I can't count how many cars got a piece of that one. I'm seeing at least half a dozen cars, including the 19, the 8, the 13, the 4, the 12, the 88, the 2, the 53, all getting a shot at that one. The 30, the 89. That was just a wacky restart to end this race. But Michael Gagne, I don't think he's going to mind. He's going to be the first two-time winner this season. This is from a guy who's only supposed to run a part-time season.
And Mike Conti will come away with his second victory of this 2014 NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series, powered by iRacing. Sturgis, Overland, Ottinger, and Peter Bennett comes home with a top five finish. And he was second coming in. Your point leader, who had issues early in the race, finishes 13 laps down in P32 for the 26 of Chad Lawton. This is going to be huge for the 5 of Mike Conti. Ray Alfala, former two-time champion of this series, he had issues tonight. He finished in position number 19, and then we documented that last lap and guys trying to stay out of the way. And Tony, from what we thought, he and Trey Eidson might have had an issue. That may have been the deciding factor in the race. It ends up not being an issue, at least when we threw the checkered flag for Mike Conti.
Yeah, it didn't end up being an issue ultimately in the finishing order. At the time, it was a huge issue for Mike Conti and Trey Eidson, but fortunately for them, the circumstances played out the way they did. Mike Conti ends up in victory lane. I've got a feeling, though, there's still going to be some words set between the 5 and the 6 after this race is over with. Call that one a mulligan, if you will, for Mike Conti, because if he had lost that race due to that situation, he would have been, let's just say, livid. Would probably have been an understatement, Joe, but winning makes a lot of things better, and at the moment, it'll probably make that better, too.
You know what else I think is to be made better, too, is Michael Conti's entire season. Remember, this is a driver who told us a couple weeks ago he was just going to keep going until it didn't feel fun anymore. And Michael Conti, so far, having the season of his life, you can guarantee as you watch him burn him out, he's having a lot of fun in that car. And now that the season is officially halfway over, I've got a feeling the best is yet to come for the 5 team.
And you look at the last win that he had, he won at Pocono 2 races ago, and that was the race that he and Brian Schoenberg, his teammate, had an incident in. Conti wasn't happy about that race. I'm sure he'll be a little more happy in just a few moments' time when we talk to him. We're going to step away for just a few moments. We'll bring you back with the post-race show. We'll talk to as many of the top 5 finishers as we can get in. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
What's inside peak antifreeze? 65 years of experience in hot and cold protection. From an independent, family-owned business that's never been afraid to give you exactly what's right for your engine and your wallet. Peak. Run true. Welcome back to the Dover International Speedway and the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing. And we have our first two-time winner in the 2014 campaign. Mike Conti comes home with the win over PJ Sturgis, Chris Overland, Nick Ottinger, Peter Bennett, top 5. Matt Busa, Brian Schoenberg, Brad Maher, Tom Lewandowski, Michael J. Johnson, top 10. Completing your lead lap cars, because there was only 13 of them, Joey Brown, Danny Hansen, and Jake Sturgis. In the 37 car field that we had this evening at Dover.
Tony Stevens, down in Victory Lane with the driver of the Oboto Gaming Cockpits, number 5, Mike Conti.
Down here with the guy who I think, there's not a big argument, probably had the best race car on the short run tonight here at Dover. But Mike Conti, did you expect to have that short of a run to try to work your way into Victory Lane?
Oh, man, no. When we had that long green flag run, it was coming to 10 to go, and the splitter was digging up the track, and Boosa was coming, and Ottinger and Brown were leaving me. I was like, oh, man, what did I do? Because I had a really, really great car Wednesday and Friday in the NIS races, and just screwed it up, over-engineered it. But at last caution, I don't really know what happened. I just saw the 12 on the bottom of the track wrecked, so I guess something happened with him and Ottinger. But I just I knew it was going to be a short run, so I undid everything that I did during the race for adjustments and put it back, took 4 tires. When I saw that the front row stayed out, I was like, oh boy, roadblock, here I come. But they got a good enough start, and I was able to sneak up the top, and they all stacked up on the bottom, and I got around them. But this win is just so great on so many levels, Tony. We needed this for the team. I needed this for myself. Jacob Seelman, one of my biggest supporters, his grandfather died, passed away this last week, so this is for him and his grandfather. This is a special win. This is my home track, so I'm just so excited that I can pull it off tonight with the whole J-Show crew.
Always special when you can have a dedicated moment like that, and we send our condolences out to Jacob and his crew over there at Speed 77 Radio and Race Chaser Online. Certainly hard to lose one of your close family members, and good to see you're in Victory Lane dedicating this one to him. Let's move back a little bit. You talked about the battle with Ottinger and with Joey Brown and how they got away from you and started leaving you. But before that, you and Trey Idson had some issues on the racetrack. Is there a backstory to that that we're not aware of? Or was that simply, what was it from your vantage point? Because we know what it looked like on the screen for everybody watching.
Yeah, your guess is as good as mine, and I'd really like to know myself. I haven't raced with Trey that much this year. Haven't been around him all that much this year, for whatever that's worth. But never have had a problem with him. The closest battle I had with him was at Texas on a late restart, but there's nothing. There's no problem there. But I was just coming up to lap him, and 53 yielded, got out of the way. I was like, all right, good, good. And then the 6 was just not getting out of the way, which was okay. You know, that's all right. I mean, he doesn't have to get out of the way, but he was already lapped down. He was going to go 2 down, so I was like, okay, well, you should really give me some room here. But he wasn't, and, you know, as you guys probably saw tonight, a lot of tires just fall off a cliff eventually with the times. And he was falling off the cliff, and I wasn't at that point yet. And meanwhile, I'm trying to keep my lead. And he was just really slow and not moving, so I hit him a little bit just to tell him, hello, you know, leader, I need to get by here. And he didn't acknowledge that. So then, you know, just a couple laps more of him being in the way, but I only got around him. I came up under caution, kind of revved the motor at him, left it at that, and he said something. I don't know what he said, but I don't really care. I don't know what he was doing, but I mean, it's cool, it's fine, he didn't really do anything wrong. It's just heat of the moment, knowing that you're going to be caught, just trying to hold the lead, and you know, I just ran into him a little bit, so I'm glad that that didn't really affect his race at all, and I'm glad that it didn't affect mine. So there's no problem there, hopefully. I don't like to make enemies. I try to keep everybody on my good side, so. But I don't really care about that, Tony. It's just great to win. I got to thank Oboto Gaming Cockpits, Jeremy Lukaska, all of J-Show Motorsports, the RCRL, JDR Graphics, Speed 77, Race Chaser with Tom Baker, and a laundry list of other people that have helped me get this far. And I thank you guys for commentating and putting on a show for everybody watching that are fans of this series. So, like I said, hopefully Trey isn't mad at me, and hopefully it just ends here tonight.
Before we let you go, Michael, next week you're going to be the point leader. Not quite sure how much the gap's going to be because you came in tied for second with Jake Sturgis. Chad Lawton's misfortune, well, that pretty much guarantees you're going to be in the point lead. Going into Michigan, How do you prepare leading the NASCAR Pecan Freeze Series points going into a place like Michigan, which pretty much marks the halfway point of the season?
Well, break out the old Pocono setup that was a half a second quicker than everybody, and hope that they didn't catch up. We had a really good car at Pocono. Really good car at Pocono, Tony, and Michigan shares some similarities. So hopefully we can do that. Hopefully the weather isn't too crazy. We won't have to do too much, but we're going to be strong there. All of Jay's show is really strong right now. We're going to keep that going, and Tim just told me that I have an 8-point lead, so take that 8-point lead, hopefully make that a little bit bigger after Michigan, and just get through the summer stretch of the season and still be in contention, hopefully be leading the points. 2012 was really close for me. That was a really hard run with Ray, so I'm hoping this year can, you know, turn out a little bit better for me. So I'm not going to count my chickens here, but we're running well, so there's no reason why I shouldn't expect good runs to come. So we're going to run well, so you just count on that.
He's been running well, no doubt. Two wins and the only multi-time winner so far this season in the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series, Michael Conti, here in Victory Lane at Dover. Joe Cortez has caught up with the guy who finished second, albeit a little surprisingly, but certainly a pleasant surprise, Joe.
BJ Sturgis scores his first top five of the season here at Dover International Speedway. And PJ, it's got to be a very redeeming feeling to not only score your first top five of the season, but score it at arguably what's one of the hardest tracks in the circuit.
Yeah, it really feels good to finish second. Last Wednesday in the NIS race, I know I was following Mike and most of the race, and I definitely learned a lot finishing second to him then and second again here. So one day I'll beat him, but for now I guess I'm the bridesmaid.
At Dover, it seems like the bridesmaid's not a bad place to be, especially when you consider the melee that happened behind you. Walk us through what you saw in your rearview mirror on that last lap going into the turns one and two.
Well, basically, on that yellow, I was going to do whatever Mike did. I was going to do the opposite. So he pitted, and I stayed out and wanted to try to wait as long as I could to make everyone get antsy on the restart, which worked, and I just saw mayhem behind me. I don't even know what happened.
Tonight's race was all about strategy. It was all about trying to make the car work for you. How did strategy play in for you and the entire team ultimately leading up to your second place finish tonight?
Well, for most of that race, it was about saving tires, and of course, qualifying fourth really helped me out because track position seemed to be everything here, since it's so hard to pass, but tried to save tires as best I could while not going too slow, and I think I played it just about right, because I was going to wind up, I think, fourth or fifth until that caution came out.
BJ, 2 weeks' time, you go to the Big D Oval at Michigan. You guys got a preview of it at Auto Club earlier this season. What's the plan going into Michigan in 2 weeks' time?
Well, unfortunately, that's probably my worst track by far on the entire schedule. So if I can get through all the laps there, I think 100 laps, and if I can finish in one piece, maybe we can have another top 10.
BJ, before I let you go, I know a lot of people make it work for you in the 57 team. Who makes it work for you?
Well, of course, I'd like to thank my sponsors, SimRoom.com and V-Racer. They definitely helped me out with their sponsorship, and want everyone to go to their website and check out their great sim racing products.
BJ Sturgis finishing second tonight here at Dover. Congratulations on the second place finish, and we'll see you in 2 weeks' time at Michigan.
Okay, thanks.
BJ Sturgis finishing second here tonight in the number 57 machine. Let's go take it to Tim Terry, caught up with our third place finisher, Chris Overland.
Chris Overland stays out on the final restart and finishes in position number three. Chris, talk about that move that vaulted you to the podium this evening.
I thought it was the dumbest thing ever until it worked. it was a last-second decision. I wanted to do what most of the leaders did, and by the time I had realized that, I mean, there was a bunch of lap cars, so I thought everyone was staying out. So I stayed out, and I realized it was just me and PJ out there. So I just tried to do my best, and when he spun the tires there, I tried not to get too far ahead of him. Didn't want to end up getting a black flag, but there was really nothing I could do there. But third's better than where I was running, so I'll take it.
Let's talk about the move that ultimately put out the final caution. You, the 32-34 little checkup. Five, I know, was rolling the outside of you, trying to get up there as well. Talk about that move that that put you in that third-place position when the caution flew.
Well, once the green flag came out, Mike just started shoving me all the way on the straightaway. I was just trying to hold on to the car. And once we got past the start-finish line and he showed his nose on the outside, I knew that if I drove in as hard as he was and tried to defend there, that I was either going to push up and destroy him or I was going to get trained by all 12 cars that were behind us. So I just tried to get down to the bottom and seemed to do that pretty well, and there was a stack up behind me. I'm not really sure what happened yet. I'll have to take a look at the replay.
You're going to move to position number 9 unofficially in the standings, continuing to move closer to the top of the heap in this NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series. We're getting close to the halfway point of the season, 16 races. This is race number 8. What is your perspective looking forward in this series for the end of the year?
Just keep having good finishes and minimize mistakes. I know that in the beginning of the year, I made quite a few mistakes as far as strategy or clearing myself when I wasn't or causing accidents, and I know that if I just keep that to a minimum and get everything that I can possibly get each week, that I've possibly got a shot here, because it seems like there's some bad luck when it comes to being a point leader. Chad had his bad luck this week. I think last week someone else had bad luck that threw Chad into the point lead. So there might be something to being the point leader and having a little bit of bad luck. So, I mean, if it keeps up, we'll just knock them off one by one and eventually we'll be up there. So I'm just going to try to keep doing what I'm doing. Nothing changes.
Question is, can you knock off a win at Michigan in 2 weeks?
We'll see. I'm definitely not really liking this tire at Speedways. And I feel like if we get a setup that doesn't fall off dramatically like all the other ones have, that we might have a shot. But Michigan's such a hard to judge track. It's, you never know who's going to be the good car until you get out into the race and race conditions. So we'll give it all we got, and if we have to do what we did tonight, we'll do it again.
Sponsors on the car, teammates, who makes that for you?
First off, I want to say thank you to Last Remote for building this awesome setup. I took the week off pretty much from building them, and well, I'm obviously not needed because the car was great. I want to thank the HD Radio Network, Double Clutch, Eddie Walzik. I don't think he's watching right now, but he needs to turn on the broadcast. Menards and just everybody who supports the 47 team, because I want to be here without them. And you, Tim. I like you.
Well, thanks, Chris. That's Chris Overland coming home in position number 3. And we hope to talk to you more on the podium, so we hope you join us next week after a top 5 finish. I believe that Tony has caught up with Nick Ottinger.
I have, and Nick, how bad does this one hurt?
Oh, it stings a pretty good bit, just to throw one away like that, essentially.
You say threw away. What exactly happened then where you felt you threw this one away?
Just spinning tires, man. Just trying to get up through the gears and everything. And luckily, I didn't cause a big pile up. But, I mean, people had to take evasive maneuvers because of me. But I know PJ was trying to bring the field down a little slow, and I knew he was going to do that if he didn't go early. So I was trying to stay right on his bumper to at least push him a little bit to go a little bit quicker so I didn't have as much wheel spin. Well, I ended up having a lot. And I wish it didn't happen, but, I mean, we still had a solid finish. We had some good green runs, and we ran strong. So you can't really be disappointed too much there. And I will still say congrats to Mikey, Connie, and everything, and he did had a good car tonight, and I would like to stay green, and maybe we've been in victory lane there.
Well, the good news is, like you said, a good run. You're up to second in championship points, 8 markers off the lead of Mike Conti. So overall, yeah, probably not a bad night. Up until that point, it looked like your car, though, was better on the long run. Was that the case, or was it just a matter of yours stayed consistent and everybody else dropped off? You know, how much, assuming all those things, how much did you really hate to see that last yellow?
As far as the car went on longer and on, we were good, definitely. I think what people were doing is they were pushing the car too much, Tony, and we were just saving the tires and having some car management majority of the times, and just not spinning the tires coming up off the corner. We were a little snug for a good portion of the run, but I mean that kind of helped us. We didn't want to push the car and heat the right front up and get too tight. But that's why we were pretty good, and just a lot of people were just pushing their car too much. And with that caution, yeah, I hated seeing it. Me and Joe were racing hard, and that's why I let him go and let him burn his stuff up for a late portion of the race, because it had a little green flag feel to it. And I caught him back, got back up to him, and was starting to get around him. And I don't know what happened coming off four. I don't know if he just lost it or if I had something to do with it as far as connection was, but I hope not, because that's 2 weeks in a row something's happened to Joey. I mean, we race each other hard and clean, and I definitely want to keep him green.
Well, hopefully things can work out here in the near future, but I know there's a lot of people that make things possible for the Gale Force Racing Bunch and put you in positions to where you can run like you did tonight. Who are they?
Matt Holden's my crew chief. He did some good strategy and everything, making sure I just conserved the car and just keeping me in check for each and every run. And he did a good job tonight. He done that, so a great job with him and Peter Fisher spotting me, and a lot of guys at Gale Force Racing, Ronnie Sisney, Ben Welvert, Brian Day. We recently added a new member to our team and everything, and he's shown some good progress and helped us out tremendously this week. And I want to thank Reem, Rude, Gale Force Suspension Management, Franklin Cable Group, Roll Speed Dynamics, Patriot Safety Supply, and hopefully we'll get another win soon, but as long as we stay consistent in this season, I think we'll be pretty good.
I think you'll be pretty good as well. That's Nick Ottinger, currently up to second after finishing, or up to second in points after finishing fourth here tonight. Joe?
Peter Bennett finishing fifth in that number 69 machine. And Peter, you were almost caught up in that melee behind you. What happened on that restart and how you were able to escape it?
Well, I started in eighth on that final restart, and I knew my two teammates, PJ and Chris, stayed out with old tires, and I knew they were going to be pretty slow. And I was really expecting tires spin because it's Dover and everybody spins their tires. So, and I knew, actually, I think there's like 13 cars in the lead lap, so I figured I might as well just go for it because I can't really lose too many spots here in the end. And I really just got lucky. I tried to, stay high, roll up on the outside. And, it was all just pretty much luck from there. Ended up fifth. I didn't even realize I passed that many cars there just going into turn one. So I'm just happy I had a little bit of good luck there.
I think you hit on a very important point there. Tire wear was critical in this race tonight. Where you were sitting, how critical did tire wear and tire strategy and pit strategy play into you being able to finish fifth tonight?
Well, usually I'm a guy that likes to stretch it on fuel, but with this new tire, it's really more about tire management than fuel management, which is all, it's a little different aspect to it. I just tried to save, those last two stints. We had a long green run. I just tried to save tires as much as I can, try to make them last for as long as they could. And I was actually going to pick up maybe one or two spots there at the end. I was probably going to finish maybe just inside the top 10. Then the caution came out, and I just decided to pit. I did consider staying out there at the end too with my teammates, but I figured the tire wear was just going to be too much with everybody grouped up close together.
Peter, this is your second top five finish of the 2014 campaign. This should put you square into the top 20 in points. What's the plan for you and the team here on out?
Well, I've been pretty busy these last couple weeks with school, real racing. I've actually I've got a sinus infection. I'm really not feeling too well. So the team really picked me up. I really appreciate that from them. That's what the team's all about, and I can't thank them enough. We got three cars in the top five for Lastro Motorsports, so you can't really complain with that. And Joey Brown was having an excellent run, and Jake Sturgis, before he had some issues pitting there, we were all pretty much running in the top 10. So I think we're really happy with how the team's running right now. And, we just look to, continue the success and build on our success week after week.
2 weeks' time, you guys are going to the big D-Oval in Michigan. How are you going to find success there?
Last season, I think I finished in the top five on fuel strategy. So, maybe that'll happen again, I hope. Lucked into a nice finish there. But hopefully I'll get a little bit more time to really work with this car. I haven't really done much testing since the updated tire. So if I can get it's one of my favorite tracks at Michigan, so I'm looking forward to it. So hopefully I can, kind of get comfortable in the car, and I'm just looking to run strong and try to, run with a pretty good pace.
Before I let you go, any shout-outs you want to give, anything else you'd like to offer, the microphone's all yours, my friend.
Thank you. I'd just like to thank the Sunday Night Lone Wolf Super Late Model Series, CrimsonPC.com, Bullet Motorworks, and Elliot Henderson for the paint scheme, and everybody at Rudy Motorsports back in the day. They're part of the reason why I'm here, and everybody who helped me out spotting today, Lee Heron, Wendell James, Ryan Rudy, Dylan Cece, all those guys. I can't thank them enough. And my team, Lasher Motorsports, they're also great too.
Peter Bennett making it 3 of 4 for Railstrom Motorsports in the top five tonight with his top five finish in the 69 machine. Great run, Peter. We'll see you in 2 weeks. Tim?
Final thoughts from this evening's racing action. Dover comes to a close, and really interesting race, Tony, compared to what we've seen the last few weeks in this NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing, and I'm expecting some more interesting racing when we hit Michigan, I think.
I think I agree with you, Tim. It's going to be fun to see how 100 laps plays out in the high banks of Michigan. 200 laps here at Dover was certainly very, very engaging tonight. We were able to see what happens when pit stops don't go your way. Strategy was a part of the outcome from the very get-go. Really, the first round of pit stops dictated where you finished tonight because of how the cautions fell. And even after that, lap traffic, tire strategy, late race restarts, a couple of gambles here and there. I think overall, probably one of the best races we have seen in the history of the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series. There have been a lot of good ones, and I think this one ranks right up there with it. There wasn't a lot of outright excitement the whole race, but for a man that likes to see strategy, likes to see a race play out, and likes to see drivers and teams have to outthink each other in addition to outdriving each other, I think this one goes down as one of the top ones we've ever covered here on PSR TV, Joe.
Very eloquently spoken, Professor. I think more importantly, though, tonight we saw a lot of drivers get really confident and really comfortable with this Gen 6 car. For the first time ever in this entire season, you're seeing guys get comfortable with the car, get comfortable with the car, with what the car can do, and get confident in their ability to drive the car. You saw a lot of smart driving, you saw a lot of engaged driving, and you saw a lot of drivers actively play the strategy game in these Gen 6 cars. So it really looks like about halfway through the season, these drivers are now getting comfortable. They're really hitting their stride. And if tonight's race was any indication, the second half of this season really ought to be one for the history books.
Yeah, this one's going to be exciting. For all the racing information on the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series, you can follow along at wcs.iracing.com, the microsite, the World Championship Series, not only the NASCAR Peak Antifreeze Series powered by iRacing, but the iRacing World Championship Grand Prix Series, which will head to Montreal on Saturday, June 7th. Our next race is Tuesday, June 17th at the Michigan International Speedway. That's when we cross the halfway point in this season. That's when everything starts to get a little bit interesting in this series. We get to start to separate the contenders from the pretenders in this championship hunt for $10,000. That's going to do it for us here this evening. So for Zach Stanko, Ian Bushing, Chuck Johnson, Joe Cortez, Tony Stevens, my name is Tim Terry. We'll see you in 2 weeks' time when we say let's go racing from the Michigan International Speedway. Keep the hammer down, and we'll see you at the track.
This is where it gets difficult. This is where your name's on the line, everything's on the line. You get that one chance to go out there and put down your best performance with the most amount of pressure.
You got to take this race car, this whole new group of people, go to the racetrack, somehow impress them, and oh, by the way, you got to do it now. It's now or never.
First thing that went through my mind was like, no way.
Just be real important to try to figure out how to get the tires under him and run a smart 150 laps.
They might bump him around a little bit, but what doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Everybody should enter next year's contest because you never know what could happen, man. You come out here and run top five in the first K&N West race. So I'm so psyched right now. This is incredible.
Inside peak antifreeze, 65 years of experience in hot and cold protection. From an independent, family-owned business that's never been afraid to give you exactly what's right for your engine and your wallet. Peak. Run true.